Okay. Situate it. The notes, microphone.
Where's your costume?
Oh, I decided after the Fear and Loathing episode that I don't think we're going to do wacky costumes anymore.
That would have been nice to tell us.
I guess I should have given you a heads up so you guys don't look like ridiculous idiots. Anyway, speaking of ridiculous, let's talk about Batman Forever.
It's time to hack the movies. Today, we're talking about tapes with Tony and Newt and Crystal.
I'm committed to wearing this for the entire review. I don't care.
It's going to take way too long to take this one off. There's a lot of tightness going on here. Mm-hmm.
So yes, we revisited Batman Forever, which, according to Pat Collins, is the best Batman yet.
Pat Collins is a liar.
Yeah. Okay, so Batman Forever. I guess very briefly, because we might touch on them someday. Mm-hmm. The Tim Burton Batmans.
Yeah.
They were fine for the time.
Yeah.
I really loved them growing up. Looking back, their scripts are kind of shitty. They really, and even Tim Burton himself will admit, like when Batman Begins came out, there's an interview. He's like, yeah, I guess I should have done something more character driven, but
they were style over substance. Again, yes. 89 Batman is the reason that I got into film.
Yes, yes.
You know, and
I respect them for what they did for Batman overall, like getting the animated series over the ground. Mm-hmm. But when you really look at the movies, it's like, these are kind of stupid, but they're fine.
But they're fine.
However, Batman Returns underperformed.
Yes.
And
but it is my favorite of the two.
And parents, I keep saying it's a better wacky movie full of nut jobs than it is a Batman movie.
Yeah.
It's very entertaining. However, parents were very upset with it.
Very upset.
You know, when you see the Penguin say, just the pussy I've been looking for, and vomiting black bile.
Yeah.
When he puts the pin on the girl's boob.
I have to turn because I have a hood on. I'm like Val Kilmer.
Yeah.
But yeah, that as a kid looking at that freaked me out. And as a kid, I was like, that's not right.
Not a lot of reflective surfaces in the sewer, huh? Yes. He bites the dude's nose up.
A lot of kids were creeped out.
Yeah.
Parents were horrified. It. Oh, yeah. Well, weirdos like us would love it. Didn't do much to sell toys. I think McDonald's was very upset with it. So, cut to this movie. And a lot of people give this movie shit. Some of it's deserved.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But what you have to realize is, so this is the studio going like, okay, Batman's still big. Cartoon's doing well.
Put off.
We screwed up with the second movie financially.
Yeah.
We need a safer film, a safer director that'll be bright and flashy and with lots of gadgets so we could sell toys.
Yeah.
So when you go in with that mindset, you start to forgive the movie. You're like, all right, well, if that's the things it had to meet, then that it works. And it worked. This movie was a huge financial
hit.
And the merchandise sold like crazy. I know this because I have a 12-inch Val Kilmer there, the Batmobile.
Nice.
I have a tiny.
I always have a 12-inch Newt around me at all times.
I have a tiny Val Kilmer Batman. And these are not mine personally, but I did own them.
Yeah.
The Batman Forever glasses from McDonald's.
These are Kieran's.
Yes. Yeah, so
I've never seen those. Those are really cool. Are they glass?
Yeah. I had a Riddler one too. Mm-hmm. So this movie is directed by Joel Schumacher.
Yes.
Tim Burton was under contract to do it.
Mm-hmm.
He technically could have done it. He was in development, but the producers, like he said, like he was in meetings with the producers and they were basically like, oh, you don't want to do this.
You
want to
do like a smaller, more intimate movie.
Yeah, and Tim Burton kind of caught on like, yeah, you know what? Yeah. I think I'm done.
His original plan was that Brad Dourif was going to be the Scarecrow.
That would have been cool.
And Mickey Dolenz was going to be the Riddler. They had used Robin Williams as a baiting tool in 89 Batman, and then they did it again to him in this one. So he was very burned out by the studio system at that point because they were using him as a bargaining chip for it. Marlon Wayans was originally Robin in Batman Returns, and he got a pay or play. He got paid not to be in the movie. Same thing with Billy Dee Williams. He was Harvey Dent in 89 Batman, and they had to pay him off because he knew that Harvey Dent was going to become Two-Face.
Yeah.
So Yeah, and then there's a lot of pictures of how they were sculpting the suit with
Michael Keaton. Michael Keaton could have stayed on, and he's like, this feels different. This
he didn't like the direction they were going in, and then they were looking to have Leonardo DiCaprio play Robin, and Michael Keaton basically got in Leo DiCaprio's ear and was like, this isn't a good sign for you.
You know who auditioned for Robin? Christian Bale.
Yep. Yeah.
Yes, so Joel Schumacher came in, who is very hit or miss as a director. He's directed some great things, some real shit things.
I love The Lost Boys.
Falling Down.
Yeah. Phone Booth, I like. Yeah. You know, DC Cab.
Yeah. He is a working man's director. Yeah. He was kind of like for hire, and he wasn't a bad director. People like really shit on him for this.
And he was a fan of Batman too, coming into it.
Yeah.
And he wanted.
And you see it in the movie. Yeah. You see there's like, even though he knows it's a corporate product and was just trying to hit beats, he does work in some really Batman
things. He had wanted to do a darker Year One style story.
And
they didn't go that way.
Nix that.
No. So we were having the conversation about this before that this is my least favorite Batman movie.
Yeah.
Only because, so hear me out. Mm-hmm. Batman and Robin is awful.
Yeah. Right? Love it.
No, I know. I've grown to appreciate it.
It's so good.
But it's pure camp. It's pure unadulterated camp, and it lives in that. Yeah. This one is a weird middle ground between the Silver Age Batman and the Burton Batman.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have the conviction to be either. And because of that, I can't become invested in this movie because it doesn't know what it wants to be.
And we're going to go into how this was like a very different movie, which we actually, if you go to Patreon,
we
literally just recorded our commentary track because we thought it'd be fun. Like instead of just taking notes like we usually do, since we're all here, because we rarely get a chance to watch all the movies together.
Yeah.
So like, since we're here, let's take notes as we're doing the commentary track. So we have a commentary track up there. We probably go into more detail.
And there's a whole thing I'm not allowed to talk about in this about Bruce Wayne's relationship with Robin.
There's some jokes that you can tell in an audio commentary that you can't tell on YouTube. Anyway, let's get into this film.
Yeah.
I really like the opening scene until a certain part. By the way, I was 5 when this came out. It was my last year of like kindergarten. And on the last day,
you're so old.
Yeah, the last day of kindergarten,
I'm dressed like Robin.
Yes,
you know,
you look like an idiot.
I know. I do.
Who would like walk around with Batman stuff on them? That's real stupid. It's getting hot here. Let me take this off. And did you guys notice?
Oh, you're dressed as the Penguin. Oh no, that's just your body.
You can get this Joker fan shirt in the merch store.
Robin's old enough to drink, we found out in this movie, so he's 25. I'm sorry.
Since I'm dressed like the Joker, we should redo that part in the comics where he beats the shit out of Robin with a crowbar.
It's fun.
Anyway.
I meant you're built like Bane.
Oh, well.
There you go.
You know, people really confuse the Penguin and Bane. They're kind of the same.
They look the same.
So the beginning's awesome when he's suiting up. And when I was a kid, like, I was already in on Batman. Yeah. I love the first two. I love the cartoons.
Mm.
This is the best Batman movie for a kid. If you want to just shut a stupid kid up, like, you put this Batman on.
All right, now let me ask you a question real quick, because we're going to get into this. And I asked you if you knew what this was, and you said you didn't. Maybe some of our viewers who are a little bit older. Does anybody remember Disney Adventure Magazine? You said you didn't. It was like Reader's Digest for kids.
Okay.
And the very first images of this movie I had ever seen was in that magazine, and they had like an arrow pointing to Robin's earring. He's hip and cool for the 90s. And I saw that. I was in history class, and a girl in my class had it, and she's like, "You like Batman? Check this out." And I closed it. I went, I'm out. And I you know, and I, again, yeah.
It's weird Disney would hype up a Warner Brothers.
Yeah.
But it was more so like kids stuff at that point, you know?
Yeah.
So if anybody remembers Disney Adventure magazines, tell me I'm not crazy.
Yeah. So he's suiting up, and it looks awesome. Like, because you're a kid, you want to see the bat suit, you want to see the gadgets.
He's grabbing silver butt plugs.
And and the previous two movies, you had to wait a little bit for Batman to show up.
Mm-hmm.
But like here, you're like seeing him right away. Mm-hmm. And then he gets with the cool car that's glowing, and it looks like an H.R. Giger thing, which Newt doesn't like for some reason.
Yeah.
First lines of the film, too, is,
"Can I persuade you to take a sandwich with you, sir?
I'll get drive-through."
And he's like, and Batman's I'll get like, trifle. I'll get
and he's
trifle.
Got the light from Morticia Adams from the Adams Family on his mouth. And this was the period of time where Batman's all did the duck mouth still. Like, because the Michael Keaton Batman was the one who did it first, like before Instagram models, the thing. And he's doing it here, you know.
So well.
Yeah. So he has to go
DSLs.
He has to go catch Two-Face.
Yeah.
Who is broken
down. I'm Robin, so dick-sucking lips makes sense.
Oh, my God.
So he has to go get Two-Face. And now this is where we'll first talk about the deleted scenes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So this movie originally had a darker opening.
Mm-hmm.
Where it would open with Arkham Asylum.
And it's in the U2 video, the Hold Me, Thrill Me, Kiss Me, Kill Me video, where it's like Rot in Hell Batman or something like that.
So Dr. Burton like checks on the Two-Face's cell and it's all written in there and you find out he broke out.
Yep.
And it's a really good opening to like show you like, oh man, there's this new bad guy. Mm-hmm. He's out. I'm glad they cut it out.
Yeah.
Because Two-Face is awful in this movie. That scene would have hyped him up as some kind of threat when he's really just a bumbling buffoon.
He is the worst part of this movie, and he doesn't care.
Yes.
It's between Tommy Lee Jones is up here and I don't give a fuck, and then Val Kilmer's right below under. That.
Yes.
Yeah.
So Batman has to go into Gotham.
Mm-hmm.
And guys, Gotham looks fabulous.
It's awesome. It's Gotham, so awesome.
Gotham is now the last firing synapses of a dying drag queen, but I love it. Here's the reason I like it. And here's the thing I say about rest in peace, Joel Schumacher.
Yes. That was him.
That was Joel Schumacher from Beyond the Grave. So go back and watch any of them. Like, go back and watch Civil War, the Marvel movie. They're fighting on a tarmac. Here it's like it's colorful and it's crazy.
But some of the Marvel movies are like Thor Ragnarok is colorful as hell.
I would be more a proponent of more LGBTQA directors directing superhero movies.
Like Bryan Singer?
Not Bryan Singer. That's one who even I think they could get behind and go, being directors of this, because superheroes are supposed to be larger than life. They're supposed to be, you know. So this movie, for all of its faults, is pop culture opera.
Yes.
It's supposed to be big.
There were, like, big statues in the previous two films, but I don't know. Well, we see the new mayor in the movie. I guess the new mayor just like is using the tax dollars to just fund these gigantic monstrosities and then draping them in neon lights.
Yeah, and the one is like
the neon.
Yeah. I don't mind the neon either, but again, it's just like yikes.
But you mainly see it during the night, and then there's one scene during the day where it just looks
where
so
it's an actual location.
We'll get to that.
Yeah,
it's so weird.
So Batman shows up.
Yeah.
Well, Chase Meridian's there. Nicole Kidman.
Dr. Chase Meridian.
Who's talking to Pat Hingle, Commissioner Gordon.
Yes.
Batman. So she's like a psychoanalyst or whatever, and she's in town because she understands criminal psyche.
Mm-hmm.
Also, she's a horn dog.
Oh, yes.
She's the horniest thing to a fault.
Yeah.
Like, this wouldn't be like, this would be hot for like a second, and then it's like, hey, I don't really want to, like, have sex. Like, someone just died over there. I don't know. Why is that turning you on? She's that kind of girl.
You get turned on about a guy who was scolded on half of his body.
Yeah, Batman shows up, and he's like, oh, what's happening? And they're like, oh, he held the second Bank of Gotham on the second anniversary of his scarring. Now, this bank, apparently, is in a skyscraper, and the vault's like in the middle of this. I've never seen a bank that was in a skyscraper. Like, have you ever seen that?
I don't get out much.
No. I'm sure they exist, but not like the big giant vault. I don't know. I could be wrong.
And how come they didn't have Uzis like the guys in fucking Dirty Laundry?
Oh my God.
Dirty Laundry. We did the commentary track.
I don't know if that's out yet.
It probably won't be, but it's coming out.
We're building up the Dirty Laundry.
That was so fun.
Yeah. So he's like, I'm going to go stop Two-Face. Yeah. And she's like, oh, she's already making moves on him. It's like, not fucking now, lady.
There's
like
a job to do. Let's go.
There's like a hostage situation. There's like a well-known murderous terrorist
in
there. When
they leave, Commissioner Gordon's like, can somebody get a mop?
So he goes in there to fight. So we all know this era of Batman.
Yeah.
Couldn't move his head.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And there's some assholes out there right now. They're like, I actually prefer that. It's like, no, it's because you grew up with it and you don't want to admit that it looks stupid.
He's a ninja. To your he youth. Needs to move like
he's,
a ninja.
He's supposed to be a ninja fighter.
Yeah.
Now, Tim Burton sucks at directing action.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he could not direct an action scene of his life depending. I guess he's gotten better since all his movies are so fucking digital and just animators are picking up the slack, but his action scenes were terrible in the previous two.
Fucking Dumbo.
I didn't see it. Was it really bad?
Yeah. So
okay, don't say it. Got it.
Whoever's doing the choreography for this and the cinematographer, their name escapes me. They filmed around the suit's limitation. Yep. Like this scene in the beginning where he comes out of the elevator.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing quick cuts so you don't linger on how awkward the head is. They're showing more close up of his like fist and his legs and
more cape stuff. The cape is more cape stuff.
So they're masking how stiff the suit is. And it almost like it, for me, it works. It tricks me into thinking like, oh, he's like an ninja now.
Yeah, yeah.
And then of course you cut to when he's just talking and he's still like this.
Yes.
But for the fight scenes, it works. And I really like this fight scene in the beginning, but this is a problem with every Batman ever, and you kept bringing it up during the movie, during our commentary. Batman stories have a problem of introducing a gadget, which would be super beneficial to him all the time, that he rarely uses. Mm-hmm. So he has a taser, which apparently can shoot someone, electrocute them to, like, have an electricity around them for a bit, and even if you throw them into other people, it'll spread the electricity. Yeah. It's like, why is he even bothering punching people?
No.
Just shoot him all the time. Shoot him all the time with the electricity.
Yeah.
It's like Arkham Knight with the car. You find out Batman has a car that it handles
worst
like
car.
Shit. It's terrible.
It's the
but
worst.
You find out he has a car that he can drive into a crowd and electricity will shoot the people. And then it's got like those rubber bullets and stuff.
Yeah.
And he can handle it remotely. It's like that Batman would never need to go to Gotham.
No.
Just like, oh, is there crime? Boom, 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 boom,
he
boom. Okay, they're down.
And there's cameras. If you look at all the other Batmans too, he has cameras everywhere. He can see everything going on.
Yeah.
Why does he need to leave the Batcave?
It's like, but the thing is, this movie, I think, does it the most.
Yeah.
Where there's constantly like a gadget that would be like, that seems
really
useful. The
one-time use gadget? Is that how this works?
In
you can
Kingdom
only use it
Come,
one time?
In Kingdom Come, he just has the drones that go out and fight for him, you know?
Yeah. So
they're like sentinels.
So we see Two-Face for the first time.
And he looks awful.
He looks awful.
Half pimp, it looks like, half business.
I don't know what's going on with the suit.
I don't mind the suit. I way prefer the one that Aaron Eckhart wore. And then the
because that was just a suit he had that was burnt. Like,
but
that's just all he had.
The purple face.
Yeah, the purple face is very cartoony.
I didn't mind the purple face.
And
because
his face
matched.
Is green
and
in a lot of the comics.
Was it the first two were... Or no, the second one was Stan Winston. And then this was Rick Baker.
Yeah.
Rick Baker did the third.
And look, I get it in the comics. It's a split line because that's easier to draw.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, other modern comics when they're have more detail.
Yeah.
But it's weird in live action when it's like this acid burn. It's just a straight line.
Yeah, you can't tell it's an acid line either. But I like the color of that neon purple pink because it matches with the neon.
Yeah.
That was the one thing I liked about that color choice is that it matched
with
everything
I did like the mood
else.
Lighting that would change.
What the fuck did it look for? I'm sorry.
I'm smiling. I'm Robin.
Okay, so Batman has to save a security guard.
Yes.
The most annoying security guard.
With a hearing aid.
With a hearing aid.
Yeah.
So he goes into the vault and it's a trap. And so somehow Two-Face has loaded up security deposit boxes with boiling acid.
And the guy knows it's boiling acid.
Oh no! It's boiling acid!
Yes.
But if they just left him in there, the acid would fill up and kill Batman.
Yeah.
Instead, Two-Face attaches the thing to a chain to a helicopter. And apparently the police don't have their own helicopters to shoot that down.
No, the police in this movie especially
they're completely
are
useless. So now the safe is being pulled. God damn that. So where we live near a like a stream, like a little stream.
Like a creek, yeah.
Near a creek. And this time of year, all the gnats hatch and they're just surrounding the neighborhood and they're in here now. Anyway.
He's fucking crazy.
He might be crazier. Maybe he smells really bad.
No,
they just really like him. Has he bathed?
No,
he doesn't take that.
This part of our town is covered in gnats. Trust me.
If we read the Facebook comments when it's just he and I or he, Justin and I, he goes, I bet it smells terrible. Crystal, how does it smell in here? How do we usually smell?
Oh,
come on.
Wow.
You smell like...
Okay.
Anyway. So here we go. I want to demonstrate what's going on in this movie. So this is the vault. You keep it like this, it'll fill up and they'll die.
Nice visual.
Two-Face puts the chain to the helicopter, pulls it out. So now all the acid's down here, giving Batman time to figure out how to use a gadget to get out. Also, why did he take the vault?
In the first place?
Just leave it there.
Yeah.
Because if Batman does figure out a gadget, his feet will be melted off. And then when he gets out of the vault, you just shoot him.
Yeah.
But instead he's doing this.
This would be so much better if the movie started like that. Like his feet are down to nubs and just like he shoots him execution style and the credits start and all the kids in the theater are like,
it's like, baby!
Yeah, kiss from a rose.
So he's flying the vault out. And by the way, I have this whole movie memorized.
I
probably didn't even need to do notes. He's flying the helicopter. Batman gets out. He uses the guy's hearing aid to figure out the combination. Gets out. But then we find out he has like this torch thing that can melt steel. And it's like,
why didn't you do that in the beginning?
Why didn't you use that to get out? So then, I'm sorry, I need my visual again. Jesus, sorry. My West Coast video, Steven Seagal, out for justice. Anyway, so now Batman's up here. The security guard and him are up here. He goes, hey, hang on to the vault. I'm going to attach my grappling hook to the chain. I'm going to shoot it through concrete. Remember, he has a thing that could shoot through concrete. That's very important later. And then he goes, all right, bye. And Batman, I guess he did the math in his head. He knew that that vault would go right back into the room.
Where it came.
Go up onto the rails. For some reason, the vault's on rails. I don't know why. And then smoothly go on there. And the guy, he just assumed the guy would hold on and not be scared or lose his grip.
Or fall it. That's what we don't see. The thing opens and he's just a fucking smoldering skeleton. Yes. Batman kills local deaf man.
We need to look. Sorry, I need my visual again.
Yeah.
I need to go back and check. Did he close the hatch on his way out? Because if he did not close the hatch, when that thing slug
everywhere,
Dr. Chase Meridian's like,
now everything I just said was stupid.
Yeah, like most of this movie.
No, because immediately afterwards, a more stupid thing happens.
Right, this movie is a series of stupider escalating.
Two-Face goes, "Oh, Batman's holding on to the chain. Let's swing and get him off." And it's like, disconnect the chain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of flying through the dry ice.
Instead, he drives through a neon, which I'm sure would, you're dead. The helicopter's not going to break through that.
And then he shoots his pilot.
Because Batman puts his cape on the window.
Yeah.
And it's clearly just his cape. And Two-Face goes, that's Batman's body, I guess. And then shoots
the cape.
Batman's head is way too close to the blades.
I said to you while we were watching, I was like, he's gonna wind up like the zombie in Dawn of the Dead. He steps up into the box and gets the helicopter.
You need help, Harvey. Give it up.
We need help. Have you looked in the mirror lately?
So apparently the helicopter was strong enough to go through that sign. But this version of Statue of Liberty, Lady Gotham, the helicopter can't deal with it.
No. Good miniature shot, though.
Good miniature. There's some good miniature work in here.
Yeah.
Oh, during this whole flying scene, there's just a giant statue of the devil. It's like a 1,000-foot statue of the goddamn devil. Yeah.
So many random statues in this movie.
I get like a gargoyle, but like that's the literal devil. I feel like, you know, there's some Christians that might live in Gotham that might be like, I don't know if I want my tax dollars going to that big of a depiction of the devil.
But it's like in Jack Nicholson says in the 89 Batman, he's like, civil people shouldn't live here. They'd be happier somewhere else. Like,
yeah.
So, also, Two-Face took the time to brand his parachute with his yin-yang symbol.
Wait, before that, he puts the club on the helicopter. And I'm like, remember the club?
We mentioned the club in something recently. There was a movie, I think we did a review where I mentioned the club, or maybe I was just thinking the club in general.
You might have been thinking the club.
Because the club was a thing you used, and it made it hard for
criminals
to steer. I don't know how that works in a helicopter.
Also,
criminals figured out that you could just saw through the steering wheel and slide that baby off.
Yeah.
So very timely.
Is Two-Face trying to kill Batman, or is he not? Because there's so many times where he could have, and he does it. I'm like, you're stupid. Not the Joker who's trying to keep him alive
yeah,
for
no,
fun.
Yeah, no, Two-Face wants to kill Batman. I know you're saying, oh, but what does this coin say? The coin in this movie is optional.
Why didn't you wait to wear the Batgirl costume till we do Batman and Robin?
Well, Tony said to put on costumes.
Oh, I changed my mind, though.
Yeah. But you didn't tell us.
I guess I forgot.
You could have been Dr. Chase Meridian.
It almost seems like I might have just like purposely that? Not told you so you guys can look like idiots. Anyway, so Batman... I know,
people are going to be like, wow, Newt and Crystal are great as Robin and Batgirl. Tony's such a jerk.
Ew. No, they're going to be like, Tony's the only adult. Anyway, those are my toys from childhood. So I really like the shot of Batman falling in the water.
Yeah, that was
and
cool.
And then that shot of him like that. Like, I want to get a poster of that. Mm-hmm. However, I really like Elliot Goldenthal's score in this. Sure, it's not Danny Elfman. But I like the
It
feels like the rejected Dick Tracy score almost.
I don't mind it. I really like Elian Goldenthal's music. Mm-hmm. You know what movie I particularly like his music in? I really enjoy his music in Alien 3.
What?
I really enjoy the Alien 3 music.
Have we ever asked anybody to YouTube Alien 3?
Newt, we did.
Yeah.
And I'll announce here. A review is coming. We won, guys.
Yeah.
We won, guys. There's some steps I gotta make ahead of time. There's because it's gonna be a big episode.
Yeah.
But that review's coming. Hopefully next month or whenever this comes out. Anyway,
we did it.
Anyway, we talked about how great the miniatures were.
Mm-hmm.
The next day we get a digital shot of Gotham. Are you okay?
This is like choking me.
Where did you get that costume? Is that an official costume?
I don't know. Luke literally hands me costumes all the time and goes, here, put this on.
This is the same one. This is the same one Aaron has.
Oh,
it's
right.
It's the 60s. It's Yvonne Craig.
Aaron has this?
Yeah.
Sweet.
Well, she wore it to
Aaron,
one of the parties.
Come to the show and we'll be
matching
Batgirls.
Yvonne Craig outfit is now like, the modern Batwoman has a version of that where it's purple.
Because Mike was the Cesar Romero Joker and she was,
You don't have a mustache on. I was very upset about that. Yeah. Anyway, so we get a shot of Gotham during the day.
Mm-hmm.
And it's digital.
Yeah.
Doesn't look that good.
No.
It looks very dated.
This is the first superhero movie that I remember to really use a lot of digital effects.
Yes. And in this movie, in this wide shot, if you pause, there is a statue just covered in tarps and chains.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it looks like there's just a giant gimp in the middle of the city.
Which makes sense because Two-Face's thugs all sort of look like the gimp from Pulp Fiction.
Oh, and they're all wearing like midriffs that show off their belly. And
to be fair, if you were in that kind of shape, wouldn't you be like, no, I want to wear a midriff?
I don't want to make any assumptions, but Joel Schumacher was a homosexual man. That might have been a smart choice on his part. I don't know.
Go read the article about him and his before his death, saying how happy he was that he didn't acquire certain things.
Yes.
And his
because he apparently was very exposed to certain things because of his lifestyle.
He would have lots of sex with just random dudes. And look, here's what I'm saying. I am a heterosexual man. But if I was in his position, I'm not in good enough shape. Like we decided, enough shape and I'm not a good enough dresser to be gay. But I'm working on it. If I was in his position, oh shit, I would be getting stank on my hang low on the reg. Like I don't.
And that's what he did.
Exactly. Yeah. And then I'm like, good for fucking him, dude. Like,
yeah.
So yeah, gimp statue. There's a gimp statue.
Mm-hmm. Hate the player, hate the game.
Hey, if you can see it, fucking get it.
So we see Wayne Enterprises.
Yeah.
Which we did not see of at all in the previous two movies. Like, Bruce Wayne was involved in some sort of thing with Christopher Walken.
Yeah.
It was kind of weird. So they're making, like, experiments and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what.
R&D, which goes into Batman Begins, you know.
I guess so.
Yeah.
And we meet Jim Carrey, Edward Nygma.
That's right.
And Jim Carrey, the character starts off good in this.
Yes.
I like the angle, although it's been ripped off, as we said. The angle of, like, the villain, like, wants to be, like, is obsessed with someone, wants to dress like them. He idolizes Bruce Wayne. Yeah.
And what I said to you was, it's kind of a fun thing, because if you look at the subtext, which I don't think actually exists in this movie.
No.
Jim Carrey is obsessed and wants to be a man that technically doesn't exist.
Yes.
Bruce Wayne doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Batman exists.
Yes.
So he's infatuated with a visage that it's not real.
Which happens. So they're like, I think we mentioned in some other review, there are like fans that become obsessed with like celebrities or just any kind of big name people. And they have this idealized version of them. And then if they ever meet the person or or something comes out about the person that doesn't fit what they imagine.
It's like
they,
when people met Tony.
Yes.
At that flea market that one time.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, the flea market in 2000. That's a callback. There was some person, if you didn't watch Ghostbusters 2 episodes, some person tried to cancel me. Yeah, someone tried to cancel me by making up a story about how I was mean at a flea market in 2008. And I'm like, I didn't, that never happened. And how would you even know that was me in 2008? Anyway.
But there's also, fans also idolize characters, yeah, which is what actually reminds me more of, when they don't realize the separation between a character and an actor.
You know who's getting a lot of creepy stuff now? Millie Bobby Brown.
I feel so bad for her.
She's like, I'm getting older.
She's getting sexualized. And she's not a child.
But not even that. There's this, the opposite is happening, where she's getting older and she's like, yeah, I want to, like, you know, wear bikinis and do makeup. And I have all these people being like, oh, you're too young for that, because they want
me to. So she's getting both then.
They want her to remain like a young child, because that's what
really
they became.
Creepy. I know. I don't like either one.
Are we talking about the girl who's in Godzilla?
Yeah.
Okay. When you said Bobby Brown, I was like, from New Edition.
She was talking about how she's like, she's growing up and she wants to do things that are age appropriate, and her fans feel like betrayed.
It's like a Disney Channel person.
So that's what I like about this, because I took a fans and fandom course in college, and at the time I was like, oh, whatever. And it's one of the best courses, because I learned like how like the mind of a fan works, and it like got me to like change
that's
myself a little bit. Yeah. So there are these people out there, they're like, this is what I think the person is, because it's what I want them to be. And then it's like, oh, because in this, he shows him his experiment. Mm. It's like, yeah, there's brainwaves. You can put things into the brainwaves. And Val Kilmer's like, yeah, but you can also take stuff out. This is kind of questionable. I don't approve it. But in his mind, he had this idea that like, oh, he's going to agree with me. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be best friends. And then when it doesn't happen, he just breaks. And this happens in real life all the time.
How do you deal with it when your fans, like, they're so
No one's that obsessed with it. See, I feel like my fans know I'm an asshole, so
they're not wrong.
There's no idealized version of me, because I'm already the worst version.
You both are.
It's the line. It's like, if you don't expect too much from me, you won't be let
down.
There's
no way I can let fans down. I'm already awful. Anyway, so that's a really great thing in the beginning of the film.
But then, of course, that whole the naughty hair glasses thing carried into, you know, the
Amazing Spider-Man 2.
And then Wonder Woman. Yeah. It's like,
But Bruce Wayne has to leave, because he sees the bat signal. And we're going to explain what the bat signal is later, because this movie forgot. Yeah. So Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
Goes to his office and he says chair, which opens up the ground. And he goes through a tunnel that takes him all the way to Wayne Manor.
So Bruce Wayne has those things that are at banks where you put your checkbook
those
in
tubes,
the thing and
yeah.
it goes up the tube. So Bruce Wayne goes through the tube from the bank.
However, in our commentary track, we realize Wayne Manor is over like a water thing full of tubes.
Yeah.
And Wayne Enterprises is over a water. So maybe he's going into a pre-existing tube.
I said that while I was like, I was trying to create some semblance of order in
However,
this world, like Batman.
The code word for this is chair.
What if
he's sitting there? And like, you know how like sometimes he's sitting in a chair and it sounds like you fart.
Yeah.
The leather chair. Mm-hmm. And someone's like, was that a fart? And what if he was like, oh no, it's just my chair.
People would be like,
what just happened to Bruce Wayne?
No.
Oh my God.
Can you imagine that impact too, as you're going down a tube with a chair, and then when you hit?
Justin and I were rearranging all of the offices.
Yeah.
Where we were clearing out the office and putting everything back together. And periodically he's like, oh, whose chair is that? And I'm like, oh, it's so-and-so who works here's chair. We said chair so many times. Yeah. Imagine like, people would come down, you'd be like, oh, Newt, we're going to film this thing, and we're both gone.
Is it just programmed to his voice? Because what if he's sitting there, and someone goes like, sir, I really like that chair. And he goes, oh, no. Like, this
or
it's like,
hey, can I sit in this chair? Or
guys,
there are so many times you can say the word chair.
This is almost as dumb as having mini bat signals around your house that aren't covered. So if you're visiting Wayne Manor during the day, you're like, oh, that's weird. He's got a lot of bat signals.
Well, no, they all had like things on them that spread out.
No,
but what
didn't.
If there's a part? Yeah, they did, because they all opened up. What if there's like?
No, I think they were just there.
No,
we'll check the footage.
They check the footage. They turned and they kind of like, you know. But again, what if he's throwing like a gala, like he did the gambling night that he did, and they're like, Bruce Wayne's a big fucking fan of Batman.
I just really think he's great for the city. I love him. Anyway, So somehow he goes into a tube into like a sarcophagus.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I liked in Batman Returns, he comes out of an Iron Maiden.
Yeah.
Because Tim Burton's a big fan of like Mario Bava, mm-hmm. and Mario Bava made Black Sabbath.
Yes.
And there's the, you know.
Yes, that all went into Sleepy Hollow.
I know.
Yes.
I like Sleepy Hollow.
Sleepy Hollow is great.
I like it.
So he goes to the.
We should review Sleepy Hollow.
We should.
I would love to do that.
So he goes into the Batmobile.
Mm-hmm.
He drives one way, and then a second later, he's on a whole different platform. Like, ha, that was really fast. I know there's some magical realism in this movie it's like what you're seeing is not really what's happening.
Yeah.
So he goes to the Bat Signal, and we talked about miniatures and stuff. The GCPD is awful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's clearly like a set with like a paper backdrop. It's real noticeable. So he shows up, and it's Chase Meridian.
Mm-hmm.
Woo.
Who's like half naked. She's ready to.
Nice. Again. Oh, stunning.
She's like.
We find out she's new in town.
Mm-hmm.
She's at her place of business.
Yeah.
And she's trying to get railed on the roof next to like the most important piece of equipment in Gotham City.
She knows what she wants.
I want to know why she left her previous city. What did her shenanigans
Yeah, they're like, look, we know what you did to
Superman. Booster. Put a restraining order on her. Like, oh god.
Booster Gold's like, yo, I'm from the future, and I can tell you some fucking shit about her. You know.
Booster Gold's like, Superman, she likes to fake pregnant.
Yeah, Blue.
And it's like, oh shit, I was gonna hook up with her. But thank you.
Yeah. Blue Beetle, show us on the doll where she touched you. Show us on the doll where she didn't touch you.
So we find out she put the thing on there to talk to him.
And all right, so Gotham City Police, okay. Your dad was a cop.
Yes.
There's always someone at the police station. People are working. So she got changed into her Victoria's Secret outfit and went up on the thing, and they just let her.
Does she have access to the roof? Is she allowed?
No, they're like, it's Nicole Kidman. Hey.
Now, question.
If Nicole Kidman is walking anywhere in lingerie,
her husband knows Xenu. Just let it happen.
Now, here's a question. So I imagine we've read a lot of Batman comics. Yes. Crystal, I know you're familiar with Batman, but maybe not as much as us, but I need to ask you.
Okay.
What is the purpose of the bat signal? Like, what is it, basically?
To signal Batman.
Okay.
It's kind of like in the title, yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of like a beeper,
It's kind of like a beeper. Okay, yeah, so Batman says, like, beeper in that time, like, in the early 90s, beepers were huge. It's just like a beeper.
So it's something you do to get someone's attention. So Batman goes,
you called me here for this. The bat signal is not a beeper.
That's exactly what it is. Yeah. It literally, I know some movies or comics, they're like, we put it up there to scare criminals and let them know he's out there.
Yeah.
Whatever. The primary function is we need to let Batman know where we are.
What if they got rid of it and instead his cell phone went ring, 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 banana phone.
Banana
phone.
Anyway. So she's laying it all out to him. She's like, hey, I have a thing for bad boys.
I love what she says.
Yeah, what did she say?
You like strong women. I did my research. Or do you like skin-tight vinyl and a whip?
Or she said, should I carry skin-tight vinyl and a whip?
Which is our only Catwoman callback. But then he's like, try fireman less to take off.
Oh, yeah, because she's like in high school, it was guys with leather jackets, college, it was motorcycles, and now it's black rubber. But I don't think, I know it is black rubber, but I think in the, what we're supposed to imagine, it's some kind of cool body armor, made out of some bulletproof material, not literal rubber.
But like, that rubber, though, with the nips and those packs, just feeling up on it. Like,
a lot of people think Batman and Robin is where the nipples came from. They were here.
And he wanted them to look like Greek statues. Rod
statues, which I get. And look, I shit on the nipples. But this... That sounded
very
wrong.
Is that a Pornhub category?
Please, please do not take that out of context.
It's just going to be... Under your face smiling, I shit on the nipples.
Make the meme now.
Anyway.
We were just talking about peeing in porn on the drive here from the porn, from we were at a horror convention.
There you go.
Anyway.
We were at a porn
She didn't know what a trucker bomb was, so I explained to her what a trucker bomb was.
I never heard
For the
of
love
that.
Of God, guys, I don't want to cut all this out, please. Can we tone it down a little bit? Anyway, so if he's also going to have, like, abs and whatnot, I guess I'm fine with the nipples. I'm like, if you're gonna go that, like the Batman Returns thing, they're not really abs. It's like this weird design.
I want a nice cod piece, though.
So here's my question, because there's a couple times during this movie, You played sports, right?
A little bit.
Okay. He was a wrestler. Did you have to ever wear a cup?
Yes. Well, when I did karate, we had like sparring things. Okay. I had to wear a cup.
So in all the years of hockey, we had to wear athletic supporters and the check and all that kind of stuff. We used to have a ref that used to like hit our groins with like, what if you weren't wearing one?
No.
And when I was in my 20s, we had a game that was forfeited.
Okay.
And I was in the locker room by myself and I was wearing still my hockey pants and all that. And a young lady I was dating at the time did something. And to get an erection in with that on is very painful.
I imagine.
Can
it would
you
be very
imagine
hard.
Being Batman and having like a raging fucking like hard on?
Because
then it's like,
hurt.
What if like guys came out at you and you're like, oh no.
Maybe the cod piece is so big to for that. Like maybe he's not packing that much. Yeah. But anyway.
And then if you take that one Kevin Smith book, Batman wears a catheter when he's in the suit.
Oh.
Yeah, no, that's in
just make a flap.
One of the Batman books that Kevin Smith wrote, they have this whole scene about like Batman wears a catheter when he's in the costume, which makes a lot of sense actually. But imagine like
Newt,
Alfred would be the guy who has to do that.
And how much time do you have to put a catheter in and then take the catheter out?
Yeah, Batman usually gets changed on the fly.
Okay, like, all right. So let me tell...
Because he already has to put the eye makeup on underneath the mask.
This is not being cut out. This is something that happened to me.
We're going to compromise.
No.
That's going to be a bonus video on Patreon. If I leave that fucking story in, everyone's turning off.
No, they're not. I think people will be like,
no, it's
whoa.
Executive decision. That is going on Patreon. I will allow you to tell that story. I cannot put it in the full video. There's no way anyone's going to watch this video all the way through if that story's
in it. All right, then we have to say that you just cut out the most horrific story ever.
If you want
to
know about the most horrific story ever, go to Patreon.
About Newt's collapsed through urethra, go to Patreon.
Go to Patreon. It is awful. Anyway, let's please, we're still in the beginning of this goddamn movie. So.
I'm drunk and dressed as Robin.
Why is Chase Meridian?
I'm actually the only one fucking drinking too.
Listen, guys.
You didn't even eat today. He's gonna fall.
Oh yeah, you're right. Okay.
Why is Chase, Batman comes up with a reason for why Chase Meridian might be into him.
Yeah.
It's the car, right? Chase digs the car.
Yeah.
It's the car.
And I don't know, Crystal, is that car doing it for you?
Woo!
It is very foul.
Gotta clean this seat, like, woo!
Okay, so Riddler, Edward Nygma is working on his brain box at Wayne Tech after hours, and his boss, like, yells at him.
Mm-hmm.
He knocks out his boss, and he, like, shows him the whole, like, I'm gonna do my box on you, and then when he turns it on... Yeah, whatever. When he turns it on,
to see my box?
Yeah, it turns into a 3D TV.
Yeah,
that hypnotizes the person. But then there's this side effect where the brainwaves, instead of just connecting with brainwaves, Edward Nygma is absorbing all of the guy's like memories and information. So he finds out like he has a superpower, which is kind of weird to see the Riddler with like a superpower sort of thing.
But the guy's watching Bassmaster from Ghostbusters 2, the show that...
However, this makes a little bit more sense than Catwoman's a zombie lady. It's like, what?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, a bunch of cats licked her. Like, that makes you a zombie? What the fuck?
My cat bites my hands all the time, and I've never once, like, put on skin-tight vinyl.
So then he turns it off. He snaps the boss out of it, and he kills the boss. He throws him out the window, which is pretty good. And I love he says, like, oh, and you think, like, oh, did he have a change of heart? He just didn't want the helmet to go.
And then just down the waterfall he goes. Don't you think, though, by sucking all those, like, you can only handle so many memories. Aren't there movies where people end up hearing people's thoughts and it drives them crazy?
That's
don't
like
you
the
think
whole
the same
ending of All-Star Superman?
Yeah.
Because Lex Luthor can hear everything that Superman hears and he's like, it's too much.
Yeah.
So we get a nice little flashback to Two-Face's origin. And this is the only time in live action so far they did his like legit origin. Dark Knight had a nice nod to it in the beginning because they wanted to do like animated series also did an explosion instead. But you see Sal Maroney in the courtroom. He throws the acid on Harvey Dent. And who happens to be sitting politely in the courtroom in broad daylight?
The Batman.
Can you imagine? Jump up over to like stop.
Yeah. Can you imagine like you're a lady who like by day, you're a fucking school lunch lady in Gotham suburbs. And then you're on the jury and you're like,
I mean, like, by the way, I don't think it was Batman there. I don't think you can go into a courthouse without ID.
Well, no, he has a credit card that says Batman and it expires forever.
Yeah, Batman's getting special treatment from Gotham that borderlines on illegal.
No one sees
check
him
out our
the...
Patreon commentary track and I'll explain why Batman gets special treatment in Gotham.
Yes.
All the best stuff is going to Patreon.
You said this is the first movie where they call him a Dark Knight.
This is the first
movie. But I think the 66 movie, they might have said it.
I don't remember them. I think this is the first. I know for a fact.
In this series, maybe.
I think this is the first time they call him the Dark Knight. In a movie.
I think it might have called him that in the 60s.
I haven't gone back and watched that one in a while.
Okay.
Mostly because I don't. Lee Merriweather is not my favorite Catwoman. I would have preferred Julie Newmar.
Or, yeah. Because
Julie Newmar is the sexiest, one of the sexiest women who've ever lived.
What about Eartha Kitt?
I love Eartha Kitt.
Yeah.
And first off, how fucking awesome in the 60s to go, oh yeah, we're putting this African-American woman as our lead villain who's has sexual tension.
I like how you're supposed to imagine it's the same Catwoman each time. Batman 66 comic.
Batman Forever Two-Face becomes a white guy.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Two-Face is now white, even though he was black in the first one. I did like the Batman 66 comic, I think, or maybe it was the animated movie. The 66 animated movie where like someone gets hit and while they're looking at Catwoman, his vision blurs, but then it's the three Catwomen.
Well, it was Grant Morrison found a way to take all of the continuities and make them work.
Yeah.
And the reason that Batman saw all the colors and biffs and bams was because all the years of being exposed to the chemicals from like all his villains, he saw those things. And I was like, that actually makes
that's
sense.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the next day they go to Wayne Manor.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not Wayne Manor. Wayne Enterprises.
Yeah.
There's been a murder. They found out the guy died, and Edward Nygma's there. And this scene's pretty great.
This is a good scene. Again,
he's just like, he was like a brother or a blah, or a cousin who visited all the time. But he goes, I love it. He's like, I found this note. You'll see it matches his handwriting and sentence structure perfectly.
Well, and again, like we said while we were watching it, because he sucked his brain waves,
yeah,
he would
it's
know
really,
that.
Really, really clever. But then they look at the security.
How did he do that? You have no idea.
He was a really great digital artist.
Yeah.
And he recreated it perfectly. You saw how good the CGI in this movie was.
If he didn't become a villain, he could have worked for Industrial Light and Magic.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. So he recreates the footage of the guy jumping out the window. Mm. And then it's like, the note is like, read my suicide. Goodbye, cruel world. And then Gordon's like, definitely a suicide.
Gordon is as useless as any cop ever in this movie. Like, the Gotham City Police Department is useless.
Yeah. But then he gets the first riddle.
Yeah.
Which is like, if you look upon my face, you won't find 13 at the place.
Yeah.
Clock. Mm-hmm. The riddle's pretty weak in this.
Yeah.
But you find out they're not trying
to be.
Apparently, like,
they hired all, like, the riddle and writers from, like, the New York Times to write the riddles for this. And I'm like, I was in sixth grade and I got this.
Yeah.
And he's the greatest detective of all
time. There's an extra layer to the riddles you find out at the end. But this is the scene you were talking about. He goes to visit Chase Meridian. But they're at, like, an actual location. Mm-hmm. It says City Hall on it. It's, like, a real building.
Right. It almost looks like down in, like, Center Philly or something like that. Center City, Philly.
But like downtown Los Angeles. Like I said, it looks like the building from the end of Blade Runner, but it's not.
You know? I went to that building.
Right.
I actually, on my Patreon, I have a L.A. vlog from when I went out there the one time. And also, there's a Joker fan video where he does crimes in L.A. And he literally did a crime in front of City Hall.
Who's Joker fan?
He's banned to Patreon.
We should beat the fuck out of him in these outfits.
There is a playlist on this channel where you can find his older videos that have been unlisted.
Or we could make a porn parody.
Anyway, so we were saying it's very jarring because everything else in this movie, other than Wayne Manor, is a set with neon and colors and stuff. So when you see a real location, it like takes you out of it.
Yeah.
But then he goes into, I guess this is Gotham City PD, and she has the biggest office in the world.
Yeah.
Yep.
And this police department looks like the one from Resident Evil 2, where it's like clearly an old museum that was remodeled to be a police department. And this is kind of mean. He hears her fighting in her office and he assumes she's being attacked.
Yeah.
But instead of being like, officers, there's literally millions of you. I assume one of you has a key. Do you hear this?
I'm going to break this door down.
Yeah. Instead, he breaks the door down and she's just
It's a really
using a punching bag.
Door?
And then we notice she's new in town.
Yeah.
She has all her boxes. She hasn't even hung up her paintings, but she put the punching bag
so
she can punch it.
You know, she guys like us out. Who take very good care of our bodies, you know, we have to make sure that we, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So I want to know how he actually kicked down that door. Like, no one's like, oh, wow. Because that looks like huge, heavy doors in order to kick down. No one's so like, oh, strong. Wait a minute.
Yeah, and they're like.
As Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
But yeah, and he can't kick anyone's ass later in the movie, but yet he could kick down a giant door.
It's a very old building.
Yes.
Yeah.
And, those buildings are meant to last, though. That's the opposite.
The news story for the day should be like, Bruce Wayne went to GCPD and started breaking everything. Like, what an asshole. He tried to break into the new psychotherapist's office. Like,
I don't understand why she's like, practicing, but she never fights in this entire film. It looks like you're like leading up for her to be a fighter.
I think she like throws a couple punches in the Wayne Manor. Not enough. Look. Like, no, you're right. This is like
it leads
setting
up
that she's gonna do something badass later.
Like, you know she's not gonna be Batgirl, but
the fact that we can't remember what she did later in the movie, if she did, means this is lame.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But it's a good excuse to have Nicole Kidman in yoga pants
and a tight shirt.
We've said this many times on the show, but subtlety does not exist in this dojo.
No,
because Batman looks at an ink blot and it's clearly a bat. It's like, oh, what do you see in this? It's like, yeah, it's a bat.
That's weird that you saw that. When I looked at it, I saw my parents being disappointed in me. I don't know.
Anyway, and then she's like, oh, here's some weird tribal thing I have, and it's a black and white doll that represents the duality of man in a movie where he's conflicted about his two alter egos, and he's also fighting a two-faced guy.
And then a guy who wants to be the other version of him.
It's like, wow, that's really on the nose. And then the dumbest thing happens.
Okay, dumber than everything else that's happened before.
So, in Batman 1, the city gets attacked by a clown who tries to gas everyone.
Yeah.
Little do they know that Batman blew up a chemical factory and caused a way bigger
He tried to gas everyone after creating a terrorist attack of, if you combine certain cosmetics together, you get a rictus grin and die.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, scary clown. And then the next movie, a literal circus gang full of more scary clowns and acrobats and stuff attack the city and take all the firstborn children and go to kill them. You would think Gotham would not be allowing circuses for a bit, or if they were, you would think attendance for the circus would be very low.
But it's like people who like take a symbol of hate and then turn around and make it a symbol of empowerment, and maybe they're like, we're going to let circus here because these colors don't run.
Yeah. Okay.
But it's so clearly a high-end circus as well, because you have all the most important people, including the mayor, that arrive. All it's in black tie because he says, I gotta get you out of those clothes. And she says, excuse me. And she's like, into a black dress. Tell me, do you like the circus? And you just see everyone black tie, formal, going to a circus.
That's how I got on the show. I originally said to Tony, I was like, I need to get you out of those wet clothes and into a dry martini.
Anyway. So they go to the circus. And you're right. The mayor's there. Like, all everyone I've noticed people. There. It's like,
Gossip Gertie is there.
Gertie, who is Bob Kane's wife. But it's like, guys. Circuses are the biggest threat in Gotham. What are you doing?
And they're like, something could happen and we're all dead. It's like why the president and the vice president don't travel together, you know?
But there's also, there's no security. And doesn't the mayor have security detail?
But you know what there is? Super fucking muscular dudes, bronzed, playing drums.
Yes. And then meet the Flying Graysons.
They do meet the Flying Graysons. But can we go back to, I get that this is a power fantasy of a homosexual man. He wants to put in these things. But did you ever look at, like, every day when I get up and I get in the shower and I look at myself in the mirror and I go, and then I look at these guys and I just go, man, like, you ever get mad at people? Like, you're an attractive woman.
Thank you.
You know? And I just get mad at people who won the genetic lottery.
I can't relate.
No,
I
look you
in the,
can't.
I look in the mirror and I'm like,
you're in a
it.
Tans. You're like Homer Simpson when he looks in the mirror and he's got big muscles. I look at myself this way and I go, I'm 39 years old and it's not getting any better. I'm dressed as Robin. And I just go, like, life isn't fair sometimes.
Okay, Newt, you drank a little bit. Let's move on.
Confidence. So we, it's about your confidence.
So we meet the flying Graysons.
Also, I have a 10-inch penis, so I measured it one time. I won a contest.
We meet the flying Graysons, and this is where we first see Dick Grayson. And they're doing amazing acrobatic stunts on the trapeze, and then he even does a leap of death without a net.
And they're dressed like the original Robin.
They're dressed like the original Robin.
Which I really loved. As soon as you see that, you're like, Robin.
And then Two-Face attacks.
And
he's going to blow everyone up with a bomb.
Okay, but here's what's funny. So the dude who sort of looks like Pauly Shore is the ringmaster.
Yeah.
Okay, not ringmaster, the Jerry Springer movie.
No, not that one.
So he's on the thing, and then he gets captured backstage by Two-Face's face bad guys.
We're all hiding in the shadows with lights on their guns.
Yeah. Two-Face comes out, and he's facing the crowd with his purple weird side. I just hit the microphone.
Yeah.
And then, so I get that the people on this side wouldn't see it, but everyone on that side's like, the fuck?
It would be like, it's a monster. No,
everyone's over there just smiling and enjoying the show, even though it's clearly Two-Face. But then it brings me to,
like, you know how, like, in 89 Batman, okay, in 89 Batman, they have the Joker jackets.
Yeah.
Okay? So someone had to make those.
Yeah.
All right? Like, somebody had to make your shirt. Yes. All right? So does Two-Face have a guy on his staff that made a ringmaster costume and did half of it and stuff like that?
Yes.
And, like, who is his boss? Like, does somebody come and check on the progress of that?
Maybe it was Debbie Mazur. I don't know. But they,
Oh, that would... Mm.
Yeah.
Because we glossed over the fact that when...
No, they haven't shown up in the movie yet.
Never mind.
So he attacks the circus with a bomb. And he's like... He's like, I'll not blow up the bomb if Batman says he's here. And then Bruce is like, I am Batman in front of everyone, but everyone's screaming.
Yeah.
So Bruce was ready to give up his identity and stuff, which I guess is very noble and stuff. And while this is happening, the Riddler's watching because he's living in this shitty little apartment.
Because Gotham City just puts the circus
on the news.
Have you ever in your life been flipping through the channels and seen the circus?
A full show.
Videos of circus, but not a live broadcast.
That's
I'm
so
sure
strange.
The news has shown like things from time to time, but not,
but
like,
not
the
whole
circus.
Life.
Not the whole circus, no.
And he was able to see all of the acrobats and everything on there.
Yeah.
So I still want to know how no one heard him stand up and scream, I am Batman.
Because they were all screaming.
Go to the Patreon and listen to why nobody dimes out fucking
Newt's
Bruce
horrible
Wayne.
Theory.
I have a horrible theory as to Bruce Wayne, Batman, Gotham.
So, unfortunately, Robin, or Dick Grayson, saves the day. He gets the bomb out of there, but Two-Face kills his parents.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it's literally like the bomb from the 66 Batman.
Yes.
It's a big fucking ball.
I do love that underwater explosion, though. It looks really cool.
So while Two-Face is shooting and everybody's shooting, the flying Graysons, instead of going like, well, this ain't our fight, they decide they're going to help.
Yeah.
And then he shoots the wire, and then they fall to their death. But in the comics,
it was Tony Zuko who puts acid
on
the
thing. Yeah.
But that's like a whole different set. Yeah.
I like that better.
Yeah, I like it better, but it made sense for this movie if you got to simplify things.
It's better
things than
Jason Todd, who was just stealing Batman's fucking hubcaps. Yeah. And he's like, well, I guess you're Robin now because I collect young boys.
So this is, speaking of collecting young boys, this is the weirdest thing. So Robin is, at what age do you stop being an orphan?
18.
Okay.
Is it 18?
It's 8.
Okay.
I'm almost positive.
I assume once you're an adult, you're no longer an orphan. You just have dead parents.
Yeah.
So,
because that would be like if you were an adult man or adult
they
woman.
They did this on Curb Your Enthusiasm.
And your parents died.
Funkhauser is like 50, 60 something. His parents died. He's like, I'm an orphan. He's like, oh yeah, little orphan Funkhauser.
Because I had a skit in, because back when we were doing Underbelly is when Dark Knight Rises came out, the movie that you were
the
in.
The movie that I was in.
And, Third Rock from the Sun kid, who was also got a ice skate to the face and
in Halloween H2O.
He realizes that Batman is Bruce Wayne because of the look in his face, and all orphans can see that. So we had a skit where every orphan in pop culture shows up at Bruce Wayne's house, and I was gonna have Crystal be a little orphan Annie, and Alfred's like, sir, there's a redheaded girl with no pupils here for you.
So Commissioner Gordon goes to Bruce Wayne.
I'm laughing at a 13-year-old joke.
Listen. So it's not that old. Jesus Christ. Anyway, so Commissioner Gordon goes to Bruce Wayne and he's like, the kid's got nowhere to go. Can you take him in? It's like he's a 25.
And you did the math. He was 25.
I did the math. He was born in 1970. It was 1995. Yeah. He was 25. So...
check the Patreon.
But also, the cop leaves and he goes, okay, I'm going to head out now. Thank you. Or they would have called social services. No one was going to call social services.
You're an adult. You. So here's
what Bruce, he's supposed to be younger, though.
Yes. Well, the movie wants us to think that, but he doesn't look
there's
like it.
No way.
So Bruce Wayne.
We're talking about me now. So I understand
Bruce Wayne.
Will you adopt me?
No.
Oh. I'm older than you.
I understand Bruce Wayne would sympathize with someone who just lost their parents. How I would see it is like Bruce Wayne goes, hey, that kid who died, I know he's from out of town.
That kid who survived.
Oh, that kid who survived. Yeah. I know he's from out of town, but he's a 25-year-old man.
Yeah.
Maybe he doesn't have, because the circus traveled. Maybe they didn't have a permanent place. He goes, you know what? I'm going to set him up in a hotel. Or one of my apartments until he gets back on his feet. Mm-hmm. I own a company. I'll get him a job. He can be a janitor or something. I don't know what his qualifications are, but I'll get him some work.
He could do gymnastics laundry for Wayne Tech.
Yeah. I feel bad for him. I want to help this guy out in his moment of need because people lose their parents. Instead, Commissioner Gordon's like, will you take this poor adult man in? And Bruce Wayne's like, I need to protect this adult man. He's 25.
And Alfred makes food for him, does his laundry.
I'll just feed it to the dogs. And we're like, Ace the Bat Hound.
The Bat Hound is in this movie.
So in the comics, and it changes continuity. Mm. Robin is a young man.
Yeah.
You know, and
he's like
Bruce Wayne sees what happened to him and it triggers something in him. So he goes, I need to harness this kid's anger so one day I don't have to face him because it was something like that happened to him.
Or it's just like no one was around when my parents, well, other than Alfred, but like no one was able to guide me. I gotta kind of figure out for myself.
Again, this is a long fucking lineage of child soldiers that we talk about on this. But Dick Grayson is the best version of Bruce Wayne's intentions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I like the... And I for so fucking long, growing up reading comic books and Batman's my favorite superhero, I was so conflicted about Robin for the longest time. Because Robin is in bright colors. Bruce Wayne's in dark colors. Wait.
Shalom Man is not your favorite superhero?
Who's Shalom Man?
Wow.
Oh, I didn't know that. I know that there was a fourth.
No, keep going. No, apparently,
Justin
you don't
and
like
I
Shalom
met
Man.
A guy at a convention when he was doing Silvermania who wrote a comic called Foreskin Man, and it was about men who like didn't like their foreskin was removed without their being asked about it, and they're like, "Can you give a? Can you endorse this comic?" And Justin and I both, I mean, drunk. Endorse this comic book, and then later on it showed up when Justin started working with the nerd and I was and he's like, do you remember doing that? And I was like, no, but it's on video. It's like the Joker's thing.
anyway,
or the Riddler's thing.
He's your favorite comic.
He's my favorite character, and I like the idea that Robin looks up to Batman. I like that idea of that. And then Tim Drake is a better, like, Tim Drake's my favorite.
No, I like Tim Drake.
Carrie Kelly's my favorite Robin. Yeah. But
we're
Tim
talking
Drake,
about, like, main,
main
like, usual
continuity.
Yeah.
Not Stephanie Brown. Remember when Spoiler was Robin?
Yeah, I remember
but
Spoiler.
It makes more sense that he would train this kid and try to help him in a way where he wouldn't become. Bruce Wayne realizes, like, this doesn't end well for me either way. Yeah. And that's my favorite thing about Batman, going back to the opera thing, is it's like, I will train my body and my mind to become the ultimate male predator to stop. Nothing bad will ever happen like what happened to me. But one day, I'm going to die.
Yeah.
And what does it mean in the end? So it's like, I'm creating a lineage of we can be better, you know? So I like that about
Batman.
You really overthought it for this movie.
Yeah, this is really,
I'm drunk and I'm getting like worked
really
up.
It's taking really long for you to get this
We've recorded
point.
For an hour. Oh, we're still in the I'm first
getting,
act.
I'm getting like yes. Man of Steel now where I'm getting like
I
really
know.
Worked up.
I'm just like, I'm getting nervous as I'm like watching you. I'm like,
there's a random serious scene where Bruce is remembering his parents. Mm-hmm. Now, this is part of the overall theme of the film that was cut out, mm-hmm. but they couldn't cut it all out because the movie would be too short. But don't worry, that's interrupted because we have to have a schlocky, the slowest car chase I've ever seen in a Batman movie. Mm-hmm. It's very slow. Everything's shot from wide angles and the cars are just like at a brisk pace, but they all have flames on them. So you're supposed to think they're going super fast. Two-Face keeps killing his henchmen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Pulls out a rocket launcher, shoots them.
Where do these guys keep getting henchmen to?
I don't know. But the Batmobile,
mm-hmm.
it has a new power where it can like go up and then shoot a harpoon and then drive up a wall.
Which is now, cool.
That's cool. But then we thought about it. We're like, wait, what happens when he gets to the roof?
Yeah.
Because there's a is he going to drive into the gargoyle? Does he break the gargoyle? How does he land? Yeah.
Have you ever done something and midway into it go, oh, that was a bad idea. Where do I go from here? Obviously, it's supposed to be a...
This review.
Yeah.
You mentioned catheters and I'm like, this is a bad idea.
It's supposed to be a callback to the 60s show where they're walking up the building.
I guess.
They did it great in the Clerks cartoon, which goes back to the Patreon story I told. But then it's like, remember the Adventures of Batman episode where the kids are telling the story?
And there's a kid named Joel.
And he's like, and Batman's car, and he's got a feather boa. Yeah. And I'm like, and Batman's car flies up, drives up the building. And they're like, whatever, Joel. Yeah. And back in the day, I was like, fuck that kid.
So then we see Two-Face's hideout.
Yeah. Oh, man, we're only at this part of the movie?
Yeah, you keep going on rant. Tone down the rants.
Calm down, drunkie.
I gotta cut out a lot. Jesus Christ.
No, leave it all.
It's good stuff I'll put on Patreon, but I'm cutting out a lot of this. Anyway. So we see his hideout.
We also missed how he's getting his name.
Right.
Riddler goes into his apartment and he's trying to figure out what his name should be.
But hold on, before that. The set design of this is awesome.
Oh yeah.
The Riddler's apartment is this cool narrow box. And it's a great metaphor for his character. His genius is blocked in. Yeah. And he believes ego-wise that he's bigger than that.
Yeah.
And it's this whole thing. But it also starts with the thing that I wanted to talk about. Mm-hmm. We have the Flaming Lips song. Flaming Lips song, Bad Days. This album, as much as I hate this movie, this is the best 90s soundtrack.
Hey, man, the Godzilla soundtrack's pretty good.
The
Spawn soundtrack's pretty good.
Oh, yeah, with the Sneaker Pimps and Marilyn Manson. And the Seal song that everybody knows is actually from Free Willy.
Yeah.
So everybody knows Kiss from a Rose. Massive Attack. PJ Harvey, fucking Nick Cave, fucking Mazzy Star, you know?
You too.
Only one soundtrack is forever. Batman Forever.
He has this thing called the Guesser.
Mm-hmm.
And it's wearing the Riddler outfit.
And it looks like a fortune.
Oh yeah, it looks like a fortune thing, but
it looks like a fortune teller, yeah.
But he has so many products. I'm like, is this like a thing he made or something?
And then
he has
a bobblehead of the Riddler and stuff like that. And you're like,
wait, what do you call it?
The Riddler.
You're adding a syllable.
No, that. The Riddler. People have said it like that. It's fine.
Riddler.
People say Riddler. You could say Riddler or Riddler. It's fine. I've heard it both ways. It's okay. Anyway. So the fortune teller dude decides for him.
Mm.
He's like Riddler, and it's like bing, 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 bing. And he's like, yeah, that's my thing now.
I would have wished I was big.
So anyway, we go to Two-Face's thing.
Mm-hmm.
He's there with his girlfriends, Debbie Mazur and Drew Barrymore.
Drew Barrymore coming off of Poison Ivy.
Yes. Sugar and Spice was their name. Okay, because I thought it was Salt and Pepper.
Yes, it was Sugar and Spice.
But I think Salt and Pepper is
in the movie.
So yeah, Sugar and Spice are there and they're trying to cheer him up. But then the Riddler interrupts and he's in his full Riddler outfit and Two-Face is not having any of his shit.
No. Nope. It's like, it's fucking clown.
So the Riddler comes up with like a proposition for them to team up because after Batman Returns, you had to have two villains teaming up for some reason.
Three in the next one.
Yeah.
True. But like you have the Riddler and then you also have Two-Face, and they're both trying to be the Joker, it feels
yeah,
like.
Yeah, it's...
You're making them feel
at this point, like,
psychotic.
The Riddler starts feeling like the Joker, and also Two-Face started feeling
Riddler
like the Joker.
Riddler is playing it more like Frank Gorshin.
No, he's playing it like freaking Jim Carey. It's Jim Carey playing himself.
No, I know, Jim Carey playing himself, yeah.
He tells him, oh, I found your hideout using this device I made, the box. Mm-hmm. You put it on a TV, and you can the people get hypnotized, and then you get their information. That's how I found you. It's like, wait.
But you didn't use it on him.
Whose box did you put a TV on that gave you the location of
Two-Face?
You've
said box many times in this movie, and I like it.
And it makes no sense, but then he demonstrates it to Two-Face how to use it, and they decide to team up. Mm-hmm. And the whole thing is like...
After saying, wow, really good thing that we own Warner Brothers cartoons, and we could show Warner Brothers cartoons in this.
So, he basically tells him, like, look, you and your guys steal a lot of money for me, fund my thing, and we'll make a bigger box, and we'll absorb all the information. We'll have all the knowledge in the world, and we'll figure out who Batman is. I'm like, if you have that much power, I don't give a shit about Batman anymore.
Yeah.
I'm getting the president's launch code,
and I'm taking care of some business. I'm in charge now.
Yeah.
Why do we need a dog's memories?
So then we get there's like a montage. It gets interrupted by probably one of the most famous scenes, but we started off seeing a jewel heist.
Yeah.
Where they're like stealing a bunch of stuff, and you think Batman's gonna show up, but that doesn't happen.
No.
And then we cut to Robin doing laundry gymnastics. What did you think of that?
I loved it. I mean, I thought that's how everyone did their laundry, right?
I do like jumps
and kicks and flips and all that to do your laundry.
No,
right?
He's like whipping it around his leg, and then he's like whipping it
off.
But
he does all this like crazy.
That's how I do laundry.
Alfred's just like, oh my God, we've taken.
I want to cut to me doing that, and Nikki just being like, what the fuck are you doing? I'm like doing laundry.
Amazing.
But this is like, this becomes surreal. Like, it's almost surrealist cinema at this point, because you're cutting from the Joker in a tiara punching security guards and hurting his hand.
Yeah.
So, to acrobatic laundry.
Yeah.
But
so
it's
that,
fun.
Yeah,
that's
it, what
the
it
whole
is
point
fun.
Is.
The whole thing it's with just, that montage. So it's a really, it's an okay montage of him doing all his crimes, setting up his business, which he sets up really fast. Already putting boxes in there, sucking everyone's brainwaves. And the whole time you're like, where's Batman?
Yeah. You have no idea.
This seems like Batman should be here, right? Yeah. So there was a deleted thing. They made some device that like threw off police scanners, and it would keep sending Batman and the police to wrong locations.
A little off the ears, Batman.
There was an explanation for how they were able to do all of this without getting caught. And it's cut out of the movie, so it's this big thing where you're like...
You're very confused. Yeah.
Like, I feel like Batman should be around.
He needs an oracle. We should shoot Crystal in the spine.
So yeah, we've moved on to... Edward Nigma now looks like Val Kilmer.
Which I love, and he even has the
mole,
and he had
and
the
then,
hair.
He has a weird Tron island where he's absorbing everyone's brainwaves.
And no one goes, like, is anyone going to do something about that? Like, forget the Gotham government and like, the mayor and the police department who's like, oh, Batman takes care of it.
Yeah.
Like, the United States is still part of the United States. Is just like, look, if you're not going to do something about this, we're going
Shouldn't his invention be, like, test? Like, don't you have to, like, meet certain requirements to put a thing
not
into
in
retail?
And is it just being sold in Gotham and that's it? Nowhere else? Like, wouldn't you do the whole...
What if it's, like, the Gotham version of Polybius? Like, they're just testing it out there, you know?
So at this point, Alfred, who sucks...
Yeah.
I like that actor, but this version of Alfred is very... very useless.
Yeah.
He basically is like, Master Dick, where are you? And he's like, oh, I'm just chilling up here. He's like, okay, I'm going to go into the wine
secret
cellar.
Secret cave. Bye.
And then for some reason, Robin wants to know what's down there. And I wonder if there was more cut out where he was getting clues to what was happening.
Well, he did ask, why are all the doors locked except this one door?
And he's like,
he said that in the beginning.
Mind your fucking business, you 25-year-old orphan.
Yeah, it's like, why do you fucking care?
I guess you're just a guest here. Yeah, so he's confused. He wants to know what's in there.
Yeah.
But why does he have to do so many acrobats in order to get down?
Because he's an acrobat.
But why, like, 20 of them?
Cut to the office. Parkour!
So he does his parkour, and he slides in and he just enters into the Batcave, and we realize this is Bruce Wayne's security system. Ready? You enter, a voice goes, intruder alert, intruder alert.
And then just shows you everything and that proved that Bruce Wayne is Batman.
All the lights come on that show all of Bruce Wayne's gadgets and vehicles and suits and stuff. And then nothing else. And it's like, wait a minute, because Alfred's there and he just looks angry. It's like, what if Alfred was outside?
Yeah.
What if Alfred went out and someone in, like, do you have any kind of defense?
Is at least there, out of remember all that in, technology. In the Snyder Cut, like, Wonder Woman shows up at the hangar where Bruce Wayne's working, and he's like, you got through my, like, super expensive defense system. She's like, yeah, it looked expensive, because she fucking destroyed it.
Yeah, like, kind of like the Christopher Reeve Superman with Lex Luthor, where he goes through that tunnel and survives it. But yeah,
I really so don't like this movie.
Oh, if you shut your brain off, you can enjoy it.
Val Kilmer goes to talk to Chase Meridian about, like,
not
Batman's.
Bruce Wayne. Val Kilmer shows up there.
Yes, I'm Bruce Wayne. He's talking about, like,
your Huckleberry.
He's talking about tortured psyches and whatnot. And she's like, Bruce, what's wrong? And he's like, my parents were killed in front of me. And she's like, that's awkward. So she goes to get some tea that she left on, and then we see there's just magazines with Batman and Batman, like, pose for all of them. Now that's fine if you were like 60s. I'm a deputized citizen, Batman, but like, I thought this was still I Lurk in the Shadows Batman. Yeah,
I said to you when we were watching it, I'm like, who took those pictures? It's like the Friday the 13th movie when there's like a picture of Jason. I'm like, well, clearly the person who took that, like, they
died.
They Blair Witched that camera. Like, they found it a year later, you know?
Yeah, and then
That's what pisses me off so much with the Dark Knights and stuff. There was one where there was a giant statue of Batman in the middle of the city.
I hate that.
But that's the opposite of what he is. First of all, how do they know all the little details?
If you look at it, doesn't really look like him.
I saw it. Crystal didn't show up yet. I went to Warner Brothers for a meeting.
But I mean, it's very vague. They had an idea of what he looked like. Yeah. They didn't have, like, a clear. But also, that last fight scene, someone was probably taking pictures.
Broad daylight, and they're like, "Holy shit, Batman showed up!"
Sure, but that's the whole opposite of what Batman's supposed to be.
In that series,
the whole point was Batman was a symbol. Anyone can be him. Yeah. I think that's what they were pointing out. But anyway, let's focus on this movie. Let's not focus on the greatest.
Guys,
let's not focus on the greatest Batman movie ever made, because I was in it.
Hey, I'm gonna go have a fancy drink. Here's the keys to the waterfall, kid from Third Rock from the Sun. Bye. Did you know that Tony was in this movie, and Joseph Gordon-Levitt, like, looked at Chris Nolan's like, what? Like,
I said hi, Chris, on the set. Tom Hardy waved at me, though.
Mm-hmm. He's like,
and then I said something about Star Trek Nemesis, and he pretended not to hear me.
Shin's on!
So Alfred calls him and is like, hey, Dick took the car. And he's like, the Jag? The Bentley? This? And you see Alfred like, the other car! And he's clearly in the Batcave. And also, it's on, like, a smartwatch.
He's got a Dick Tracy watch. And Chase Meridian is like, well, that dude's fucking, you know.
Yeah.
The guy from Top Secret is clearly Batman. Like,
but she still doesn't know
it. By the way, Top Secret had Michael Goh in it.
Yes,
that's
it did.
The first time they acted together.
Yep.
But
that's a great movie, first off.
So how did Robin get the keys for the Batmobile?
Well, my car doesn't really have. I have a
yeah, you but, still but, need like, the toggle.
Wouldn't Alfred be like, no, you can't drive this? Wouldn't Alfred have? We see later Batman's got a remote that turns everything off. Alfred should have been like, no, I turned off the car. You're not taking that.
You're not getting the fuck out of here.
So anyway, Robin takes it. Yeah. He goes on a joyride.
Circus so lame.
Don't you think it would have more of like a facial recognition and stuff like that?
No, his security system sucks.
Yeah.
But he drives past the McDonald's.
Yes, he does.
So he picks up his Batman Forever mug. He says hi to Salt and Peppa, and they're like, you're not Batman, you're Batboy.
Yeah. And then again, like, when the gang shows up, they're like, look, even if that's not Batman, we're gonna fucking take this car and say, oh, we killed Batman. And then everybody else in Gotham is gonna be like, well, those the Dayglow dudes in the blacklight paint are clearly the new kings of Gotham City.
Yes. So Robin goes to save the girl.
Yeah.
He's going to fight the neon gang. And like, you're not Batman. He's like, I forgot my suit. It's like, Jesus Christ. So he fights them. He saves the girl. But then
he kisses her, too.
He kisses
her. Later in the movie, though, they say that he's never seen a naked woman. I was like, well, he has no problem kissing girls, it seems like, saving girls.
That's two completely different things, like kissing a woman and seeing a woman naked.
But like,
completely different.
I kissed a couple girls before I saw the naked Crystal.
I'm sure you've watched porn and then also kissed girls. I think that's how a lot of people
work. He wants to be bare naked with the girl. Okay. Anyway,
Like the Bare Naked Ladies, the band.
Anyway, oh, okay, gotcha.
And it's so been apparently, 1 week since we started this review.
Anyway, so apparently there were more Neon Gang members mm-hmm. around that were just waiting to get a call.
Yeah. I love
that. They show up and then the real Batman shows up mm-hmm. and they just scurry away.
Yeah.
And then we get like a.
I do like the look of the neon guys. I don't like the ship. I don't
mind
it.
They come back in the next one.
Yeah,
and I actually don't mind this little series of scenes where it's like Robin is talking about like, yeah, I had all that rage. I felt like I was fighting him, even fighting you, and it made me feel good. And then he's like, yeah, you don't really want this rage, kid. I've dealt with this. Yeah. So there's some good.
Once it's done, I love that message. Once you kill Two-Face, you're going to be searching for that next person to kill, and that feeling's never going to go away. I thought that was super powerful because it's what he's dealing with.
You asked, why is Robin so good at fighting? And I mentioned...
Yeah, because they don't show
that. I might be wrong. I know
am I so good at fighting?
Oh, my goodness.
I know this scene exists. I don't know where it was going to be in the movie, but there is a scene of Robin practicing fighting on like a... Those like logs
like
with the
Karate Kid 3 thing.
Yeah. And like I think Bruce gives him advice. I believe that would have, if it was smart, that would have came earlier to justify why he's such a good fighter.
Yeah,
because there is a scene where he's being taught how to fight.
Because Bruce Wayne like literally like he doesn't let Robin out until he's trained. Yeah. And not the Jim Lee Frank Miller one.
No, not that one.
He traps him in a cave and makes him eat a rat and calls him a bad word.
And then we find out at the gala. Mm-hmm. That Nigma is putting on where he looks more, he has the mole and everything. He's showing off his box thing, which I think was already made, wasn't it? Or is this a new thing?
This is a new thing. This is a hologram. So you're able to see a 3D TV, which is fine because that's different in the
90s. It's like, what
is so a 3D TV? So now you can actually, it's a hologram.
It's like a virtual reality,
fantasy.
Basically.
Yes, of your fantasy. Which I'm like, okay, so your brain doesn't really get affected by this.
Yeah.
It's just this random guy grabbing my brainwaves, which I don't know, but I'm actually not see. If I can go to a hologram of my fantasy, fuck it. There's no information of mine that's...
But this is the funny thing.
Wouldn't
it's
it
like,
just
what
be me?
No. Oh. Listen, maybe your death.
What is the passage of time in this film? Because they're like, oh, Bruce, how do you feel that Enigma stocks outnumber yours? It's like, his company already went public? Like, what the fuck is happening here?
Bruce Wayne was gone for years in Batman Begins and his company hadn't
gone still
public.
Wasn't public. So they're really rushing things there. And I mean, it's a stupid comic book movie. I shouldn't think about it that much. Bruce Wayne goes into to investigate the machine.
Well, because Drew Barrymore gives
she
him
takes the thing out. She shows him how it works.
Yeah.
And then he's like, okay, well, I trust you, clearly evil woman.
I trust you, Gertie from E.T.
Yeah. And then he goes in to explore it, and then she puts it back in.
Yeah.
Because she had an extra brainwaves.
You see a bat.
Which comes back later. But then Two-Face gets bored and attacks because it's been 5 seconds since a fight scene happens. Because this movie can't go five seconds without some action.
And it goes so long. All the fight scenes, they feel a little dragged out.
But this scene's awesome because he comes through the ceiling.
I do like when he comes to the ceiling.
And then he does a flip over the people. And again, this is another great
example. And then a random guy goes, it's Batman.
But it's another great example of them filming around the suit's limitations and actually having him be like totally badass, which I really like. And then Chase Meridian, because she's such a horn dog, she's like, my house, midnight. And Batman should be like, I might die.
Yeah.
Can you not? Sure, I'll try to swing by. I have a lot to deal with right now.
There's also a part, though, I actually took a note of this, where Bruce and Enigma literally put on glasses at some point, just randomly as they're talking, trying to outsmart each other, put glasses on, and then they take them off. And I was like, when did they ever?
Well, because Bruce goes to, leaves the party and goes in the back of his car and gets in the bat suit.
Yeah.
Now, I'm wearing this fucking stupid shit, and I still needed help getting into it.
Yeah.
You know? Imagine, like, the elderly British man who has to be like, fuck this.
So then Batman sees Two-Face going into a tunnel.
Yeah.
And he does that cool CGI jump that was in all the advertisements.
And it was in the OnStar commercials. As well. And Booger from the Revenge of the Nerds movies was the Joker in those commercials.
Oh, right. Yep. I actually watched one of those. Yeah. I didn't realize they did a Riddler one.
Mm-hmm.
So Batman.
You mean the Riddler?
Riddler. So Riddler. Batman goes through, he lands, and it's a trap again.
It's a trap.
Yeah. Two-Face
Oh, wait, where'd he go? Oh, there he is. Oh,
okay. Two-Face destroys a gas line and fires a rocket, which I think would kill all of them.
Yes.
I think they'd all be dead, but luckily the fire only goes one way.
But if Two-Face died knowing that he killed Batman, would he be okay with it?
Yes.
Probably.
At the end, he basically accepts his death.
But luckily, Batman has a liquid metal thing.
He's the T-1000 all of a sudden.
That he couldn't use any other time when he's in danger.
I wasn't sure what that was. It looked like liquid metal and it protects him from the fire.
It does, because it forms his entire body.
But then he gets covered in rubble.
Yeah.
Two-Face thinks he wins.
And he can't get out of that. He can get out of flames, but can't get out of rubble.
Two-Face also makes a fart joke because it said gas.
Yeah.
And he fires a thing, and I'm like, ugh.
Yeah. But I really like the scene where he's, like, covered in the rubble, and you think all hope is lost, and then Robin's hand comes down and pulls him out. And the music swells, and as a kid, it's like, yeah, that's
Robin,
so cool.
Robin has awesome core strength.
Yeah,
he's like the guys in Solo with the magnetic boots, and I'm like, look, say what you want. Those guys have fucking awesome core strength. If they miss shooting people because they're sword troopers,
yeah,
it's fine. Because can you imagine having that kind of core strength?
Yes.
I wouldn't mind seeing him naked.
Anyway, so they go back to the cave they're fighting because
the fit one.
Oh, I thought you were saying the stormtroopers. I was like, we don't know what they fucking look like.
Anyway, they look like Finn, you asshole.
Oh, that's true. Anyway. No, because they're just random strays. Like before,
they looked like Aquaman's dad.
Which is funny because Chase Meridian would go on to be Aquaman's mom.
They go back to the cave.
Yeah.
And Bruce Wayne is like chewing Robin out. He's like, you're an asshole, blah, blah, you don't do that. And he's like, I'm going to be your partner. You can call me Nightwing or something like that.
And they're like,
They have the whole, like, you're not allowed to be my partner. Put this next to the bats. It's a whole thing.
Yeah. You can't stop me.
But in this scene, I think, is where there was a scene where a news reporter comes on. And he's blaming Batman for the creation of all these villains.
Yeah.
Which happens a lot in the comics and the cartoon.
Yeah.
These weirdos destroy next. A library, a museum, City Hall, our lives and property are in danger from this menagerie of costumed freaks. Batman, if you really want to help Gotham City, turn in your cape, hang up your mask, put the Batmobile on the blocks. In a word, retire. I'm Kenneth Frequency.
And I think this puts it into his head that because he already thinks Batman's a burden.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this scene was supposed to put in his head that he's kind of responsible for everything that's wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which would make sense for a scene coming up, but instead they cut it out.
Yeah.
But they left in him going to Chase Meridian's house at midnight, and she's looking pretty fine underneath that sheet.
Oh, my naked goodness.
And it's like a scene out of Dracula. So
it does look like Dracula.
I expect Gary Oldman to show up, but Gary Oldman as Commissioner Gordon as Dracula.
But
she's the lightest sleeper, by the way. Yeah. She just automatically can sense him.
I love that she makes out with him.
Yeah.
And then she's like, wow, I've been fucking up. She's like, I keep dating, like, I have a obsession with men that are not right for me and are kind of weird. And I made up, and like in that moment, she finally matured. She's like, I guess a girl's got to grow up sometime. I'm like, what? Just because you made out with Batman? Like, she finally looked at him.
She doesn't realize that Bruce Wayne and Batman kiss the same.
Yeah.
You know?
Or like their eye, nothing. Yeah. Nothing about that. You're this close to
Mary Jane
him.
Watson kisses Peter Parker
or
one time.
Or maybe it's like, she kissed him earlier, didn't she?
Mary Jane kisses Peter Parker and goes, oh, fuck, Peter Parker's Spider-Man.
Yeah, I guess. And then she's like, you know, it's weird. I'm kind of into Bruce Wayne for some reason.
And it's so stupid when he turns and does that smile.
I like that smile. It's finally good. So then we go back to Wayne Manor.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if this is all on the same night. It feels like it's a really long night.
And it's Halloween.
And it's Halloween now.
It's a long Halloween.
Yes.
Because this review's been going on forever.
Yes. And then Batman. Oh, it's going to be heavily edited. You're not allowed to do these drunk anymore, you asshole. Anyway. Yeah. So Batman, it cuts back to Batman. He's like, I quit being Batman. Click, click, click. And then the movie, you're just like, wait, because you made out with a girl and she said she wants to fuck you. You want to quit?
You're like, remember that?
That's because we lost that scene.
This is the second. It's not your revenge of your parents. No. That's not why you started this all in the first place. It's because of a woman.
My parents were killed in front of me. I'm going to make sure this never happens to anyone. I made a promise on my parents' grave. I fell down a hole. I saw a bat. I'm Batman now. This is who I actually am. Like, Batman Beyond, he's like, in my head, like, I'm not Bruce Wayne, I'm Batman. Yeah. Batman took over. So it's like, this and The Dark Knight Rises, it's just like, I'm gonna go enjoy a fancy drink in Italy and you guys can deal with it.
Oh, I hated that so much.
You shut your mouths about the best Batman movie ever made. At least with Dark Knight Rises, at least with that, the first time he quits, it's after they put like a law and order that kind of calms
down. Order? Yeah. Special victims unit?
They pass a law that like really like crushes organized crime, so there was less of a need for Batman at that point.
Bum bum.
Yeah. And then after Dark Knight Rises, he sets them up with a new Batman, so at least there's that. This, he's just like, I'm done. And we brought up during our commentary, like, was he not investigating any other crime? Yeah. Like, Two-Face is still...
Two-Face is out there. Hey, there's a fucking dude who's made of clay. There's
Do you want to capture them first and then quit?
There's like, a mob.
But again, the rich in this country don't care about the little man. Again, it's like the fundamental flaw of Batman. Yeah. It's like, I'm a dude who just really likes beating up the poor and downtrodden and mentally ill, where it's like, Bruce Wayne, hey, you have all this money. He's like, hey, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to invest it in mental health. I'm going
to
invest it
in... Which they've tried to do in comics.
Yeah, I know,
then,
but it's just like, instead, he's just like, I'm a fucking rich psychopath who just likes to go beat up people with mental problems.
Yeah. Anyway, Bruce goes to talk to Chase after Robin leaves.
Yeah.
Because he's upset. He starts to tell the backstory of how he became Batman. And he was like, yeah, you know, my parents died. And then I saw my father's journal and I knew he never writing it again. And then I fell into a cave and I saw a bat. Now, there's more to it.
Yes.
It feels like a weird flashback that doesn't build to anything.
No.
Because everything's been cut out and moved around.
Yes.
It feels like a waste of time, honestly. Yeah. It just feels like they threw that, they left it in there because
the movie would have been too short.
Yeah. Exactly.
So we have a really nice, and by the way, I love how all the flashbacks are filmed with the blue lighting.
The blue flame and all that kind of stuff.
But it doesn't fit.
It reminds me of at that, again, like 87, 88, 89, they did like the whole Batman Year 2 stuff where Bruce Wayne has this whole thing where his dad is like doing the stock ticker and Bruce Wayne comes in and messes up and his dad hits him and that's one of his last memories before his parents get killed, and it plays into that whole thing.
Yeah.
And I remember when I saw this originally and then I saw the deleted scenes, I was like, oh, they played some of that Batman Year 2 stuff into this, you know?
Because Joel Schumacher did read the comics. Yeah. He took a look at it. Tim Burton is famous for saying he just didn't.
He was dyslexic and he didn't know how to read a comic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe not the best person to adapt to media. Anyway. No. Yeah, so
what if it's manga and it's backwards?
So anyway, Two-Face and Riddler show up in costumes and they beat up Alfred's stunt double.
Oh,
the very obviously young
so
man
funny.
With sprayed white hair.
So not only do they have a bad alarm system on the Batcave, but the front of a giant mansion, there's no alarm system or security or anything.
Halloween, because they knew that would be the day that Wayne Manor has their gates open for the rest
of the
year.
Pretty sure
there was
you could
no
still
security
get through.
When Riddler came up on his moped
and
his
put the
Vespa
sign-
and put the Riddler on.
Oh, that was earlier, yeah.
And you clearly saw who it was,
but also Riddler has Batman's like memories and stuff, so now he knows the layout of the house. Even if there was a security system, he knows a way around it, which he shows because in his Riddler staff he's able to hack into everything because he knows all the security stuff. And he goes in and he's 2 seconds away from literally biting the scenery.
Yeah.
He just goes full Jim Carey with these wind up bats that he's blowing up everything.
He literally says the words, his famous line, spank me. And I'm like,
spank me.
Stop. I couldn't. I'm not a big Jim Carrey fan. Like, I just don't like his character. It's just not my favorite.
But you're younger. Like, I remember in Living Color. I remember Ace Ventura,
I watched The Mask and Ace Ventura and stuff. It just wasn't my thing. That's all.
And then
all.
Reunited with Joel Schumacher on the number 23.
Right. Anyway, so he blows up, like, everything in the Batcave.
And then
screams joygasm as his bulge is just popping out of
and
his pants.
And it doesn't make sense. Like, okay, so Batman's supposed to go out on the street and his suit's supposed to be fireproof and bulletproof.
Well, he didn't go down there and hit the button that turns it liquid metal.
God, but still they should be. And then he's just
and
able
the
to
Batmobile,
blow it up.
The Batmobile has been in how many fights, how many fires, how
and
many?
Suddenly there's no more shields.
little explosion.
Yeah.
Ruins it?
So he destroys
the cave. Fuck you, Akiva Goldsmith. The Academy Award winning writer of
Beautiful
Mind. What is it?
You said Ridding?
Whatever.
Riddler. This mask is really starting to hurt my face.
You can take it off.
Oh, I can. I'm committed to the bit.
Okay. So, it's a bit. Anyway, as this is happening, Bruce and Chase are fighting all the henchmen.
He slides across the table
like an asshole. And then, like, the whole, the ultimate character betrayal of Two-Face, he's flipping the coin to get the outcome that he wants.
Exactly.
Because he wants to shoot Bruce Wayne.
Which is so, like, let's take all the years of the character development of that, of Two-Face, and go...
And throw it out the window.
And I'm like, that's not what the character... No. Like, that's not the point of the coin. What the fuck? Anyway, so he shoots Bruce Wayne.
And it's because also the Riddler also said, like, hey, you're not allowed to shoot... Shut the fuck up. You're not allowed to shoot him. Yeah. Like, that was the whole goal and stuff like that was, hey, you're not allowed to kill him. Whatever happens, you're not allowed to kill him.
But then he was like, oh, I want to. And then he does go to kill him. Riddler stops him again.
He shouldn't be on the ground in the first place, by the way, because if you're fucking Batman, I'm sorry, but your suit isn't giving you the powers to be able to kick someone's ass. You can kick a fucking door down, but you can't kick
Wasn't he able to just knock all those dudes out?
He should have been able to.
That was weird. You know what it is? Without the mask, it's easier to tell Val Kilmer's stunt double.
True, yeah.
And maybe he couldn't do all this.
And he was going through a divorce at the time, and he didn't want to be there. And he's like, look, Bruce Wayne gets shot in the head. I don't care.
And at this point, Chase still doesn't know who he is.
You know, it's pretty obvious.
Chase doesn't realize who it is until he literally... Wait, when does she actually realize?
I guess the Riddler announces it later on. When they're held hostage,
But you don't see any reaction from Chase at all whatsoever.
Yeah,
you don't see her seeing that Bruce and Batman are the same
Crystal,
person.
Crystal, this might shock you, but parts of this movie are not very well made.
What?
Anyway, but here's a
now
big...
Now that we're talking about this movie, now I'm actually thinking instead of just sitting there and enjoying it.
So like I said, they've been cutting out most of the subplot, or actually it's like the main plot of Batman's like duality. Yep. In this scene, he wakes up with amnesia.
Mm-hmm.
And Alfred has to, like, get him to discover who he was and who he is. And he eventually takes him to the cave beneath the cave.
Uh-huh.
It's the original cave that he fell through. I misremembered the deleted scene here, and I misinterpreted it. And we went on a long rant about it, and we were totally wrong. So I've since rewatched it, and now I know what happened. So here's a quick summary. Bruce gets brought into the cave beneath the cave. And he finds his father's journal. And in the journal, he realizes it was him who wanted to go to the movies that night. So that's why his family went to the movie theater, was for him. However, they ended up seeing a different movie. He wanted to see a cartoon. They wanted to see Zorro. Either way, it was him that put the idea in his parents' head that they should go to the movies. And then they got killed. So even though it's not his fault they got killed, he blames himself. And you realize the whole time he's like, why am I Batman? Why am I doing this? And then you realize it's like, oh, I feel personally responsible. So I am making up for it. And he discovers why he did it again. And he's rejuvenated. And he realizes he's Batman. He comes out of the theater, the cave, saying, I am Batman, Alfred. I'm Batman. And all that was cut out.
The whole thing where he goes and he, like, faces the giant bat.
Oh, yeah. So the bat that he sees is actually a giant bat. And I have a card of it.
Mm-hmm.
I remember I had the trading card. I was like, what is the scene of him with the giant bat?
I'm surprised they put out a trading card for a deleted scene.
Oh, that happens all the time. A lot. Yeah.
We were just talking. NECA put out a toy for the last Predator movie featuring the Predators that wore U.S. military outfits.
That weren't in the movie.
They were cut out of the movie.
Yeah.
But I guess they started making the action figure before it got
cut.
It's kind of like, I have a Force Awakens Constable Zuvio toy.
Oh, wow.
Because that was one of the first toys they released for the movie before, like, Ray and shit, and he's cut out of the movie.
Yep.
That's
anyway.
Because in The Dark Knight Returns, Bruce goes into the cave when injured to face the bat because it's his power animal, and he's insane, but it refocuses him.
So in the cut, he just wakes up, and they're like, well, we got more riddles.
We better do this riddle.
Yeah, so he's figuring out the riddles, and it's like, the riddles were easy to beat, but then they're like, oh, there's a number in all of them. Let's match it up with letters, and they get Mr. E.
Mystery.
Like Nigma, Mr. E. Nigma. And it's like, you still don't know he's the Riddler? Like, it's pretty fucking obvious.
It looks like
he's got green everywhere.
There's question marks everywhere on everything.
Do you know that Jim Carey originally wanted to play the character with a shaved head, but with a question mark shaved into all the sides?
But
he was going through a divorce at the time, and he would have to go to court. And they were like, this probably isn't the best look for you.
So then they figure out who he is, and they know where he is because it's so obvious. He's on the giant scary island with all the green light.
When they make that, they shine the bat light into the sky.
Yeah.
And then there's the question mark above, which is a cool image.
Yeah.
You know, because I said to you guys, it was like there used to be a Warner Brothers store, and the Warner Brothers store opened, and this was like the thing that kicked it off.
Yeah.
And it was all Batman Forever merchandise. And I remember I told people how much I hated this movie, but on a family thing, they go, oh, we got you a Batman. You like Batman? I was like, not that Batman.
I love this Batman. So yeah,
it's fine.
He's gonna go fight crime, but all his suits are destroyed except for the sonar suit. Look, it's the sonar suit. It's a special suit that helps him do sonar things. I guess. And it has rocket boots, we learn.
Well, the rocket boots come in handy.
Anyway, he puts the sonar suit on. And he's getting ready.
Boots have rockets on it, though, if you're a Batman. Don't you think that's a great thing to
have? Some of them have ice skates
in them, yeah.
Yeah, so he's getting ready. And apparently the Riddler blew up everything except for the bat plane and the bat boat.
Yeah, he missed them.
He missed those. Even though he has all Bruce Wayne's thoughts and memories, he just forgot about those. So he's like, do I go by sea or air? And then we hear, how about both?
Robin shows up.
In the Robin suit. And they're like, who's...
With nipples.
And they're like, who's your tailor? And it's Alfred. It's like, when did Alfred...
Have time to do that? Yeah. I didn't know he was that good.
Did he take a bat suit and color it differently?
I want him to design some things for me. Because he's like, hey,
Alfred, you let Vicky Vale into the Batcave. You built this fucking kid a suit. Yo, you're fired, dude.
You're fired.
Yeah, go ahead and tell people Bruce Wayne's Batman. No. No one's going to believe you.
So I don't get how the bat plane. Oh, by the way, they're all partners now and they shake hands.
And they I know what his name is.
Robin
now
has a big dumb mask on, like my big dumb mask. It has an R in the middle of it in his oily T zone.
Because that logo was new at the time, so they wanted to put it on merch.
I didn't even notice that was on here.
Yeah.
The suit's really baggy.
Anyway, Batman's plane is hanging upside down like a bat. I get the visual, but it's like, wait, how does he take off? Because as soon as it detaches, it's just going to crash into the ground. Do you have enough time to go like this? And then we realize parts of the cave have a tunnel for the plane, but then there's parts with like stalagmites and stalactites
Stalactites and stalagmites.
Right?
There you go.
Yeah.
He's got it right the first time.
You shut up, Riddler.
Anyway, so there's parts that are like made that he can fly, but then there's other parts where he has to swerve around. It's like, why wouldn't you? What the hell? Why are you risking your life flying this thing? And then the bat boat just goes out of tube.
that tube that nobody goes, hey, you know that big tube that's under Wayne Manor that's got a bunch of crazy lights in it?
Yeah.
Does anybody want it from the gas and water?
How often is Batman getting in a boat?
Yeah.
I don't understand that. Anyway, so these are clearly toys that work because I bought them.
Yeah.
They go to the island, those vehicles, as a lot of these movies are famous for Batman having a vehicle that just gets destroyed right away.
Yeah.
So they just get destroyed.
I mean, the bat plane in 89.
With that stupid gun. That was so dumb.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're playing like Battleship to destroy the planes. It's so dumb. But they finally make it to the island. Mm-hmm. I'm speeding things up here. They make it to the island.
Mm-hmm.
And what's the ground like on the island?
Holy rusted metal, Batman. What? The ground, it's all full of holes and it's rusted, you know? And it's just like, that's a stretch.
That is a stretch.
How about Holy Long Review, Tony?
Yeah. Oh, no, it's going to be edited down. What I like about that scene earlier, if you look, when Batman's on the thing, he's like picking up his cape to dry it out.
Yeah.
He's going like that to dry it.
His capes are good for fire?
I guess not so great for water.
When he turns the corner at one point earlier in the movie, he does the thing that I did upstairs.
Yeah,
because I had the cape on and I was all by myself, and I was like,
"So the island raises."
Yeah,
and Robin's sucking it, and Batman goes to shoot his hook onto it.
Oh my goodness!
So he had a hook earlier that can break through layers of concrete and like rebar and shit, and support a giant vault.
Yeah,
but this thing just bounces off because it's metal, I guess?
Maybe the Riddler destroyed the other ones.
Maybe he did. But don't worry, because Batman goes into like the little tube thing.
That just happened to be there. There just happens to be a door.
And by the way, and then there's like this spike that's lowering into the rocks.
Yeah.
But there's holes big enough for him to climb
through. Climb through that.
But instead he goes to the gear where he can just get sucked in and die. And he turns on his rocket boots, which flips over. This is what you call padding. This isn't a very exciting action scene.
No.
But I do like that shot where he comes up through the floor finally in the room.
Pops up through it.
Yeah.
And then the Joker has his kind
Joker?
Of...
Joker?
What's it?
Riddler. The Riddler.
Riddler. So Riddler is finally embracing his ego.
Yeah.
And he's sitting in this this throne that's with the thinking
with
man.
With the rotting thinker.
Yeah, and it's all full of his lights and all that kind of stuff.
Outfit.
And I was like, I get it. He's finally becoming his... pathos, his ego, you know?
Just and, skin-tight outfit with gems, and it's an outfit that I would probably wear.
He goes through many outfits. We glossed over it, but he goes through many outfit changes.
In the middle of this, like, he's like Cher. He'll finish a conversation and go change and then come back, and does everybody just wait for him to change his outfit? And they're like, so what are you gonna do? Like, fucking Batman and that guy is here. What's the guy's name? I don't know. He's given him a name yet. and they're like, you're gonna go change now? And he's like, oh, sorry.
Anyway, while this is happening, Two-Face fights Robin.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Robin gets the chance to kill him and decides not to.
Yeah.
Because this Batman told him killing's wrong.
Yeah.
Who I think is still the Michael Keaton Batman who literally blew up a circus strongman in the previous film. Yeah. Anyway, but Two-Face holds him.
He set that fire breather just fucking on fire. Yeah.
So Two-Face has the gun.
Yeah.
And he's just like, you're stupid. I got you hostage, I guess. And then Batman's there.
Even though Robin could kick his ass at that point. He could still kick his ass.
I think he can still kick his ass. Yeah. But Riddler does his whole bad guy speech, and I love the whole, was that over the top?
I can never tell.
Because Jim Carrey was criticized a lot for being a little over the top. But that's when he reveals he has the two people hostage. Mm-hmm. Classic sadistic choice.
You gotta choose.
And he's just like, the love of Bruce Wayne's life. Or his junior partner in crime. And he says his dream is to one day be bare naked with a lady. And it's like, he's 25 and he's a nice looking guy.
He's a very nice looking guy.
I'm ugly as fuck and I didn't get laid till I was 22. So
what a fucking brute.
I'm better than Robin.
Yeah.
And now I am Robin.
Oh, we glossed over the most important thing in the movie.
Oh no, what's that?
When he was putting his sonar suit on, they showed his butt.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, they do the suit up scene from the beginning again, but they show his butt, his gluteus maximus.
That was one of my favorite scenes. Yeah. It was so funny.
Mm-hmm. How come in the next...
You know what else we glossed over?
What's that? Uh-huh.
The thumbs up!
Oh,
see,
yes!
You talk so goddamn much that I tried to speed up the review. Sorry, back rewinding a little bit. At one point, Gordon's like, well, he's not coming. Turn it off. Mm-hmm. Turn the bat signal off. But
Stop
then he hears.
Playing with toys.
I don't know. I want to see what this one looks like.
But then he hears the bat plane.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And Batman comes through the bat signal. And then he turns. But I guess the way the suit is, he couldn't get his arm up. So it's clearly someone else's arm.
Yes.
But Gordon's
so
in his pajamas with his hat on. And I'm like,
why is he always in his pajamas?
You're all worthless. The cops do nothing in Gotham City.
Can anyone turn the back signal on? Like
the
every
back signal?
The bat signal.
Can Riddler turn the back signal on?
Shut up.
So anyway, back to the island. The sadistic choice is about to happen.
Yeah.
And Batman's like, I have a riddle for you. Mm-hmm. And the Riddles are like, ooh, let me know what it is. And he's like, I see without seeing. To me, darkness is whatever. And he's like, oh, you're as blind as a bat. And that turns his sonar in, which helps him throw a batarang at a giant glass object in the middle of the room. I'm like, what are you talking about? Batman could have just, he doesn't need a sonar suit for that.
You and I could have done that.
I probably could have.
Yeah.
But why did he... Why did he need sonar for that?
He didn't.
What the
It would have made more sense if it was like the fucking, the pinpoint you needed in the Death Star to make it work. Yeah. And he had to throw a batarang through that. But
or
then
like
also
a specific in
the movie, place. Yeah, in the movie
the
before.
The previous movie has a programmable batarang that he,
only dogs can stop. Only poodles can stop that.
So stupid. Anyway, so the thing explodes. It's like taking the Riddler's brain out of his head.
Yeah.
He releases both of them, but Batman saves both of them.
Yep.
Because it's Batman.
And we see Dr. Chase Meridian's butt.
You see her butt for a second. Yeah. I always like that scene. Mm-hmm. And then you think everything's fine, but Two-Face is still around.
Yeah.
And he's like, wait a minute, Two-Face, you can't shoot us. Oh, by the way, they're on like a piece of scaffolding that was not there in previous scenes. It just showed up. He's like, hey, Two-Face, you can't kill us. you need to flip your coin first. And Two-Face has been Two-Face should have been like, have you been watching this movie? Have
like, fucking, have you paid attention the last 2 hours?
Yeah. Like, and he's like, okay, Bruce, you're right. You're always a good friend. Mm-hmm. And then he goes to flip the coin, and then he throws all the coins.
Why? One, where the hell did Batman get all these coins out of
Batman
nowhere?
Batman also works at an arcade, and he can do that little chain like, belt thing.
Wouldn't Two-Face just grab any coin?
Yeah. Yes.
Because it clearly hasn't mattered the entire movie.
Yeah.
He was flipping the coin to get the outcome that he wanted anyway. It doesn't matter. Nothing matters.
So then he falls. And, you know, Batman made that good point to Dick, like, don't murder because it's wrong. And then Dick spared him. And then he goes to fall and Batman just lets him.
Yeah. And then there's a lot more murder that happens.
But then the coin lands in his hand.
It's pretty good.
And it's sort of like the scene in 89 Batman where the Joker's hand goes down.
Yeah.
But stupid.
Yes. And then we see Jim Carrey, whose face is all mutated.
Yeah.
And then we get Batman saying, I like chose this. Yeah. I'm Bruce Wayne and Batman, blah, blah. And it would have had more of an effect if we saw the deleted plot line that led up to it.
Yes.
But then we cut to Arkham Asylum.
The first time Arkham is in any live action movie.
Yes. Yep. It would have been earlier in the movie, but it's here now.
Yeah.
Also, they mentioned earlier in the movie that Metropolis exists.
Yes.
And we never got to see that Nick Cage says, crossover.
And the next one he goes,
this is why Batman works alone. And then
Superman works alone.
Superman works alone. And then his head is like fucking Kathleen Turner.
Yeah.
Like
so Dr. Burton shows Meridian
who
the things.
Looks like Tim Burton.
Yeah, he goes, he says, the Riddler says he knows who Batman is. And she's like, do you know who Batman is? He's like, wait. I'm Batman. He's flapping around.
Like
so his brain
scene.
Is like destroyed.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I like that she calls him a wacko. It's a callback earlier. And then he's like, all right, we're in love now. And she's like, don't stay up too late. And then they run toward the bat signal,
which is so stupid because you can see them.
The ears
are wiggling.
Yes.
But there was an alternate ending.
There was an alternate ending where they're both Batman and Robin are standing on like a gargoyle and they're like
posing.
And it looked fucking cool.
You get like there's blue screen footage of it, but they never actually finished it.
Why didn't
it.
They do that?
Because they were probably running out of money. And they're like, oh, it's going to take long to chemically process that
like,
matte shot. Let's just have them run.
Hey, McDonald's, give us some more money. And they'll be like, okay.
But yeah, so that's Batman Forever. I think this could have, if they left all that stuff in, it could have almost been a good movie. It would have been a better movie.
But then you wouldn't know what tone.
Yeah.
That's the problem. It's you either shut your brain off and you and just, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
I wish I could shut my brain off and this. You shut your brain off and you just enjoy it. That's what I feel like this movie is supposed to be. It's not supposed to, you're not supposed to dive into it. You're not supposed to pull it apart. You're supposed to just sit there and be like, this is fun and colorful. And
so what I'm guessing is a lot of the more serious character stuff was from early on.
Mm-hmm.
And then in post, they decided, let's just cut to all the fast parts.
Yeah.
Let's keep it under 2 hours. So they got, and I think it made it a worse movie, but as a business choice, I'm glad they picked one tone and stuck with it.
Yes.
Minus a few scenes that they couldn't cut out because the movie would
have
been
over. But it was already 2 hours long. So if they actually had all those scenes in there, it would have been just way too long of a movie and the pacing would be
even more. I mean, eventually you get 2.5 hour long Batman movies, but at that point people weren't really
ready
for that.
You're not into it, no.
Yeah, but I think, look, Joel Schumacher did what he had to do.
Mm-hmm.
People are like, release the Schumacher cut, but I think he was okay with those changes. I don't think he was that invested with it. And it doesn't matter. It did well.
Mm-hmm.
It sold a bunch of merch. I bought a bunch of the merch.
You were there. Yeah,
I think it's fine. Like I said, it's the most entertaining Batman movie for a kid. It's not the best Batman movie.
No, because Batman and Robin is.
But like, I don't hate it. I don't really hate any of the Batman movies anymore. I did for a while, but I'm like, I'm an adult now and I don't care.
Baby, like I can pay you to a kiss from the rose on the grave.
Ooh. And yeah, that is Batman Forever.
This review took forever.
It did.
We're literally coming up on 2 hours of raw footage.
This is Ghostbusters 2
like
level.
Longer than 2 hours, I'm
Newt
not gonna lie.
Is never allowed to drink before a review again. I'm gonna have to do so much fucking editing.
The light on the dark
so
side.
So go to Patreon to listen to our commentary track.
Love remains.
Go to Patreon to listen to our commentary track. Go to Patreon to see all some of the stuff we cut out of Newt's long ass rants.
Baby!
Thank you. Please thank me for cutting them out because they went on forever. And yeah, we'll come back with another Batman movie, I guess, at some point. And can you guys dress like adults?
I want to dress like Poison Ivy.
You're a child. I'm like a really cool, tough guy.
Yeah.
That has Batman toys.
You shut up about my Batman toys!
Remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Check out our other videos and Patreon page. Talking about tapes.